if you look at the development, especially of human, the most important formative years are first 2 years of life. Mm-hmm. It's well-owned synaptic connection being established. Mm-hmm. And what you learn in these first 2 years is a billion times more than everything else. What do you do during this period? You don't fight, you have no sex, you don't provide for your food. You play. And it has no purpose, no goal, it's just having fun. Extension of that art and science is continuation of this play. When you learn something basic like language or perception of the world, when you're a child or mathematics, it's a different mechanism. Not everything you learn without a goal, but something happens without goals, and this you want to understand.
How do you think that people conjecture the Pythagorean theorem?
You take this stick, you know, and project it on three walls. And here, three shadows, you measure them. No matter how you turn it, the sum of squares doesn't change. It's a miracle. And it's a miracle there is an orthogonal group. And why an orthogonal group? It's a huge, non-commutative entity, extremely, unbearable. To write, actually, in matrices, even rotation is very painful, right? Yeah. You need complex numbers. You cannot write a matrix for rotation easily, mm-hmm. or in three space. And here it's non-commutative, so it's all, and you know this group determines lots of things in this world. You know, in quantum mechanically, the symmetry, the spectrum of the Schrödinger operator shows all kind of like Pythagorean theorem. And I think in mathematics, lots of such things we don't quite understand the origin. And of course, many of this orthogonal group built into in our bodies, what I was mentioning, you know, rotation in your joints, rotation in the other lecture in your eye. We kind of have already some intrinsic knowledge of that. How it happens that you think about your two different brains, think about something, come to the same conclusion. And then what happens in your brain has nothing to do with logic, of course. It's not logic or something else, because these things exist in a certain way, and they can crystallize in your brain by some mechanism, and this mechanism probably similar, maybe they're dissimilar, and how it happens. Well, what means mathematics outside of you, I don't understand. This we cannot kind of point this to talk.
You saw Kleiner's daughter the other day climbing a
sculpture. This sculpture near the courant, yeah?
Yeah.
And I was really scared looking at her, because if you fall down, there are these metal edges and you can break your, not just your leg, but your head. But when we were children, we were all doing that. And,
right.
And it was real fun. And it's a picture you cannot afford it for this generation. Yeah, it's dangerous, and you never know what to do. But if you don't do that, you don't develop a thing right. Yeah, you have to be scared.
So what kind of dangerous things did you do when you were a child?
Well, anything I could, of course, climbing the trees, you know, running after the cars, jumping from the cars and back and forth, and bubbling buses.
Just jumping from the cars back and forth?
From the cars, from buses or tramways. Uh-huh. You're running after the tramway, jump in and jump out. Mm-hmm. And this was just a common activity, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, hell dangerous, but still fun. I still remember it. It was the most enjoyable thing you do, yeah. Exactly, because they're dangerous. And yeah. And of course not allowed, yeah.
And then at some point at 40, you started walking on a rope.
Yeah, but that was accidental. I've been to Texas, I think Austin, and there was a theater class, and they were taught students walk on the rope, and so I joined them, and mm-hmm. the instructor explained to me how to start doing that, mm-hmm. And so I was doing this afterwards and learned it pretty fast in about a week, yeah. You can become pretty good at that. And it's extremely good kind of activity, yeah.
In what sense?
You just try it and you become real strong, yeah. Because lots of things, just anything you do on the flat surface, you do there. Just sitting down, lying down, whatever. And uh-huh. I went to a point, then I stopped doing that. And everything requires tremendous coordination and physically much more difficult. So you develop in a very nice way. And it's accepted more dangerous, even if you're 10 inches from the ground, it's quite dangerous if you do it wrong. So you need some safety instruction. Uh-huh. But it's very pleasant, right? Because you concentrate, you really have to concentrate like doing mathematics. You forget mathematics, you have to concentrate. Yeah, so. Uh-huh. And it's easy to arrange, yeah. You just need a row between two trees and that's it.
This reminds me a little bit of your, how you started Spaces and Questions, your essay from 10 years ago. You started wondering about how the brain makes mathematics.
Yes.
So you've been thinking about it for 10 years now, roughly.
Right.
So what have you
learned? No, but I wrote almost a book about that. Yeah, it's hardly I can say into words, yeah. I think there is mechanism how it works, and I have some guesses how it works. But it's conjectural and underdeveloped. I still haven't full picture.
What's the name of the?
This Ergosystem. This is my conjecture. There is this Ergosystem in your, It exists in a way, in a virtual way. It's not physical or whatever. It's some abstract structure which functions, and not only mathematics. Everything you perceive is created by this. And we are unaware of that for obvious reasons.
Can you explain a little bit about what's an Ergosystem?
Well, again, just like you have to start from the point of the ergo brain, because otherwise it will be not motivated. Mm-hmm. Because there are two levels of description of your kind of mental activity. One is neurophysiology, and essentially it's like physics. Yeah, you describe electric currents, excitement, whatever. And then there's psychology. You describe, well, essentially how you communicate with people. And there is a huge gap between them. And so this is supposed to be intermediate language. And
the Ergosystem is the intermediate language.
It's a language. So I want to immerse this in a broader context so we can talk about that. Like, psychology is immersed in our kind of interaction with people. It's kind of common sense. And so it's hardly, at least a significant part of that is just common sense, not much of a science. And neurophysiology, like physics, is slightly removed from what you perceive as your mental activity. And so you need some intermediate. And yes, as I argue, there is a good reason such thing is there, and it's kind of related to the old debate between Wallace and Darwin, what was the mechanism of evolution of human intelligence, higher consciousness, and they kind of disagreed, and I think both were wrong, and so Darwin was saying it was a sexual selection, and Wallace, I think, well, he was close to the truth, saying it was something transcendental involved into there. And if you can translate transcendental as mathematics, then it's, I think, what it is, yeah. It's a mathematical machine which was evolving by the laws specific to this machine having very little to do with selection. And this is well confirmed by the modern moralist view on genetic evolution, which I told you about the book by Kunin, yeah. Mm-hmm. So selection has a minor factor. I mean, it's against, you know, this gradient goes against selection. Mm-hmm. With selection, we would be on the level of amoeba. If you are subject to selection. And there are many, many things in genome which move you in this direction, and it's superimposed on how this mathematical structure can evolve. It has severe limitations. And they have a rough idea what the structure is, and they describe it, but it says rather mathematically it's not that simple. It's simple, but on one hand, but it's not standard mathematics.
Right. So no one knows, more or less.
Well, yes, I have hints. I think I know the basic ingredients, but I don't see at this point how properly to organize them to derive. So the only way to check it, you have to make computer program based on these principles. And some of them I made in a different group of people, but ODIA, they have the group of robotists who make robots on very similar principles. Mm-hmm. And they display quite amusing behavior. Mm-hmm. But the major principle, which we both agree, that it is not solving problems. It's quite different from solving any problem. Your internal mechanism doesn't solve any problem, like survival, whatever. It doesn't care about that. It has their own kind of agendas, and they have nothing to do with solving any problem you want to be solved.
Sort of how you started getting interested in mathematics when you were a kid?
It's hard to say. I became interested in mathematics kind of on a more or less serious ground when I was about 15, I guess.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And basically because I came across accidentally rather good books with mathematical problems. And so I started solving them and just found it for fun, yeah. Unlike what you could see in school, yeah, which was a bore.
When you talk about problems and selection and problems and mathematical problems, these are completely different.
No, no, just selection for kids. Yeah, the problem for kids, so there were books in Russia when they just collection of interesting problems in mathematics.
Right.
And so just you start looking at them and then you start solving them. And then you get hooked.
Yeah, I understand. But before you were saying that Darwin was wrong because
Darwin was existing on sexual selection. He was kind of believing that naive selection, which could work on producing new structures, which now everybody believes is wrong. Yeah, his major premise is probably wrong. And Wallace was making conjecture there is an extra structure, but what he thought about the structure was also wrong. And nowadays we don't know what the structure is, but in some instances, not in mental, we know this something about the structures. Yeah, how genome evolve. Yeah, but mm-hmm. and they don't evolve just by selection. I mean, selection is trivial. It's there, but it's trivial component, so to speak, of the mm-hmm. mechanism. Yeah, like you select students for faculty professors. Yeah. Mathematics doesn't work because you select these professors, yeah, but because there are good mathematicians. The same with selection, yeah. I mean, it's trivial part of this, yeah. Just how distributed in the world, and those who not selected to go without a job. But this doesn't explain why mathematics is there. Mm-hmm. And the same with evolution, I guess. Mm-hmm. There are way genome organized in a very subtle way, and for reason we cannot explain, but it's now well documented. For the last 10 years, yeah, there is a tremendous amount of data.
So you started thinking about mathematics when you were 15?
Yes, well, maybe some pieces of that somewhat earlier. Maybe I read some books, but I got seriously kind of emotionally involved maybe when I was about 15, yeah.
And then you had to choose career at 18?
Yeah, 16.
16?
Yeah, so it was just, and then the next year I was attending, there was this called for students, for children from the school at the university, they were run. This mathematical, I don't know, kind of called circle in Russia. And there were two students from the university who were running that, and it was pretty good, yeah.
They were young.
Yeah, so it was my first kind of encounter with a mathematician and mathematics, and they convinced me to go to become a mathematician.
Were they charismatic, these two guys?
Yeah, they were quite charismatic. They were quite a nice guy, yeah. One of them, unfortunately, died in an accident quite a while ago, and the second, I think, is still alive. They were quite non-trivial characters, yeah. I remember them, yeah. I remember them very well, yeah, of course.
And then you went to school? And
then, no, then I went to university, right?
What are your first sort of memories of that?
Well, the problem was at the beginning, you're supposed to attend lectures.
Right.
And this was pain in the neck. But then after you pass well, kind of you have exams every session, every so semester. And after that, that was good, you don't have to go to the lectures.
Uh-huh.
Well, I don't know whether good or bad, but I never attended any lectures of the kind. But this was good, yeah. So.
You stopped attending lectures?
Right, absolutely.
After like what, 1 year?
No, after half a year.
Half a year?
Yes.
Oh, that's fast.
Sometimes some professors insisted, so you come there and play chess or whatever. But lectures was, I couldn't learn. Actually, I learned listening much later to a lecture. But they just were unable to follow the lecture.
So you started learning just reading?
Yeah, you're just reading, you're talking. There were special seminars and there were special courses which I attended because exactly they were not supposed to attend. So you attend those, which I understood very little, but that's how it worked, yeah. and this one, not only me, just with the whole group of those of students who were good enough doing the same. Yeah, it was kind of common. Mm-hmm. It was standard procedure there, yeah. It was supposed to be this way.
Eliashberg was one of them?
Yeah, sure, yeah. Yes, everybody who became a mathematician, who had some ambitions, was because we're learning it for all the students, how to behave. And they tell you, yeah, of course you don't go to these stupid lectures.
But everybody works a lot, or worked a lot.
Yes, of course we're doing that. And just before exam, of course, you have to learn the subject, so I have to borrow this manuscripts of written notes from somebody and just during the night learning them, and it was okay, yeah.
And how were you as a student in general? How would you evaluate yourself as a student?
No, I was reasonable. I don't think I was exceptional. I was. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you became really good friends with Eliashberg from the very beginning?
Well, he's 2 years younger. Mm-hmm. And so he started doing his mathematics, I don't remember, I think before, after getting to the graduate school. I don't just remember. Well, but you can judge by the papers we written together, more or less.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it was 1970.
But were you good friends before
no.
research?
No.
You started working together and the relationship?
He was also a student of Rokhlin. And that was we started communication.
Why did you choose Rokhlin? You're a geometry.
There were little choice at that time at Leningrad. There were not many kind of professors in geometrically oriented domains. Yeah, and the geometry, the classical geometry, was extremely old-fashioned. Mm-hmm. And not so exciting, and Rokhlin was certainly the most exciting figure. He came to the university the same year as I did, as a professor, and I was a student in 1960.
How old was he?
He was about 40 at the time. Mm-hmm. And he was very kind of a non-trivial character. And he was a very impressive character. And he knew topology, and topology at that time was considered, you know, like mystical science. Nobody knew it.
Uh-huh. And I mean, describe him a little bit more, his personality. Why was he so impressive?
Well, he had a posture. He was a kind of playing a role always. He had a very hard life. Yeah, he was Jewish and he survived the concentration camp. No, it was prisoner camp, not concentration camp, prisoner camp in Germany. Pretending he was I think, somebody else. And then after then the war, he was liberated and sent to the labor camp in Russia because he didn't serve enough in the army. Yeah, being in the prison was considered like desertion.
Oh, wow.
But eventually he was extracted from there and went to Moscow, and he was very brilliant and made very good work. And then he was kicked out of the Moscow and was spending time in small towns and on the north.
Why was he kicked out of Moscow?
Well, I mean, it's just hard to say, but the reason essentially why not. I mean, we had a good reason not to be. I don't know exactly why and what could have been exactly the reason, how it happened. It could be for no reason at all. Just after graduation, you have to go somewhere. And there were various stories you can hear, but I don't know the truth. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then eventually Alexandrov, who was then the president of the university, brought him to Leningrad. Mm-hmm. And he certainly had tremendous effect, influence, because he knew modern mathematics. Because traditionally, all mathematics in Leningrad was, you know, 100 years old. They were very good mathematicians, but it was 19th century. Mm-hmm. And he was the one who knew modern mathematics, both topology and ergodic theory. He was running two seminars on both subjects, and he was extremely good at that, and he had many students.
Were you similar in personalities?
No. He was made up. Kind of the way he behaved, he was just behaving in a certain way because he believed this was the way to behave. He was always kind of playing. He was very closed, very closed.
Very closed,
yeah, very closed. And he was just
good sense of humor?
Well, limited, I would say, yeah. No, he was very close, and all this kind of past was kind of hidden in him and just was weighing. He was not a simple person. Mm-hmm. He was very, very difficult personality, I guess, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was not visible, but sometimes it was showing up, yeah.
Who were the other people that you learned from?
Well, there was Buraga, who was a geometer, and he was not in the university, but he was a very good geometer, and he is a very good geometer, with whom I communicated a lot. Then there was, I think he died recently, Boris Venkov. Mm-hmm. He was algebraist, and he was the one who really understood lots of the algebra which was happening at that time. And he was running a seminar on algebra. In algebraic geometry, in Lomi, in this, in Academy of Nud, he was not at the university. And I think he knew indeed algebra, and he could explain it. And at some point, there was Dinnik there, who was probably this, but he also was Dinnik was a very nice character. He was running seminars for students, which was common there. And so I was attending and somewhat interacting with him a little bit. Well, interacting, I mean. I mean, he was a big man then. I was a student. And, well, there were some other people in Boston, in university, and in this academy.
And what about other students that you learned from?
Yeah, of course, there were students around, yeah, from whom I learned, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, but I had a friend of mine who actually committed suicide at some point, who was an analyst. Mm-hmm. And he was a student of Linick, with whom I communicated a lot. Adlin. But, well, just you don't notice this, yeah, you immerse into a certain medium and just you live there and you don't notice whom you interact with, yeah. Mm-hmm. Some you remember and some not quite, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, if I try, I may, of course, recall more, but essentially I mentioned everybody. Vershik was also there, who definitely has some influence of a certain kind. Well, there is more. All the time you pick up things from people.
Then you came up with your result. Your first result was a generalization of Smale and...
Well, it was not exactly the first, but it was... my first paper was about Banach conjecture.
Banach conjecture.
Yeah.
But you don't like that paper?
No, why? No. No. I couldn't solve it completely. I still saw it. Sometimes I come back to that. Yeah.
Okay.
It's kind of exactly this application of topology to geometry.
Uh-huh.
And this is from
I quite like that paper.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's not finished. You see, I mentioned this. I was trying to prove this Dvoretsky, which I couldn't. But this is the only thing which I could extract from that.
Ah, I see.
Yeah.
So that was a...
Yeah, this motivated by Dvoretsky theorem, yeah. And I tried to prove Dvoretsky, and this I couldn't do, but that at least came out of this. Uh-huh. And still, the question not quite settled. Of course, it's just, it's just a puzzle. Yeah, it's not a serious problem. But when you cannot do it, you're annoyed. And so you want to do it. And... Then I had some paper, kind of combinatorial, which was rather stupid, because I'm not completely responsible. It was how it's called, Sommerfeld Den relations, yeah, for polyhedra. Mm-hmm. Because I read some paper actually by Wall. He was proving some special case of that, as if it was new, and I thought it was. So I proved the general.
Mm-hmm.
This relation was very happy. Nobody pointed out to me it was kind of. It was slightly more general than Sommerfeld relation. I had this article of that nature.
This is only in Russian, right?
No, maybe it's translated, I don't know. Yeah, it's about 68 or something, yeah, mm-hmm. of the same time. And then I was working with Smale Hirsch, yeah, and found out you can do it.
Rokhlin pointed you in that direction?
No.
He
had no influence on me in this respect, no.
Okay.
He was running seminar. Uh-huh. But in this respect, of course, I was learning things from the seminar, but personally, he once tried to give me a problem, it was a disaster, I couldn't do anything. So he didn't try afterwards.
Uh-huh.
And, but then just what I was thinking about Smale Hirsch, and then the point which I discovered to my surprise, when you don't really think kind of creatively, but just try to be pedantic and formalize things right, and then they come by itself.
Uh-huh.
You don't have to think if you do it right. And this was very much, I think, under the influence of Venkov, who was really teaching algebra and explaining the kind of categories and how we have to think in these terms, etc.
Uh-huh.
This now I realize it was very much under his influence, yeah, though we never talked about that.
And then you kept going, right? You kept going until you found the H principle.
Right, then we had some joint papers with Yasha, because Yasha was proving something similar using singularities and whatever. And he proved this kind of his folding theorem.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was interesting because when he explained this to me, I said, well, it cannot be true because if it is true, then it would imply existence such and such example.
You said?
Yeah. And next day, Yasha showed me a picture of this example. And this happened to be known to Milner. There is a famous kind of picture, kind of very paradoxical, two disks immersed with two different immersions with the same boundary.
Uh-huh.
And so then you believe into that, yeah. And then Yasha was pushing this singularity, and then we had some joint paper combining these ideas, and then I think we formulated this H principle. It was, I think, the name it appeared first in this paper. And then I wrote another paper with convex integration, which I think that was the most interesting, because it gave the most general results and most paradoxical results. And this was motivated, of course, by Nash-Sivan embedding theorem.
This is the one you went to present to Gelfand?
No, I don't think so. No, it was with Gelfand, was before that. At the time when I was speaking to Gelfand, I didn't have kind of special case of that. First, I was proving case after case after case, and then I realized that they follow from general mechanism.
And what was the anecdote there? He said something like, one of us is an idiot, and you answered.
He said, well, somebody here something doesn't understand it at the time. I said, of course you don't understand it. You're not supposed to understand it. It's too difficult for you. He was very happy with this.
He had also a pretty intense personality, right?
Oh, yeah. Still, his very death. I was talking to him before his death several a few years ago. Yeah,
And he was very, very good. He was a rather obnoxious person in a way, but I never noticed this. With me, he was very nice always. Some people complaining he was very obnoxious, very arrogant, whatever. Mm-hmm. But when I was a student, he was nice because I was a student. And then we just developed this attitude. So I can tell one good story. Actually, I think why he was high opinion of my intelligence, because it was a thing, he was some day he was in Leningrad, and he was staying with his friends. And then I came there in the morning, and we started talking mathematics. And he was kind of half dressed. And then he couldn't find his socks. And so the whole family of the sister was, you know, crawling under there looking for his socks. And then I say in between, can you check on your pants? Maybe the socks are there. The socks were there. Yes, that's really there. After that, we had a good relationship.
I see. You were invited to the International Congress?
In 1970, yes. And then at that time there was an epidemic of minor, of cholera in Russia. We were supposed to have shots. Uh-huh. So I had the shot, but an official reason I was not allowed to go because I couldn't, for medical reason, I couldn't have been given the shot. So of course not, I wasn't allowed to go, yeah, because only people in certain official delegation could go.
So you didn't go?
No, I didn't go. It's Alan Weinstein who presented my talk there. Yeah. It was in Nice, 1970.
And then it was kind of, was it kind of tricky to keep your name not too famous in the USSR?
Well, I mean, just nobody cared. I mean, it was no problem. Yeah.
Mathematics, after all.
No, nobody cared about that. It was no problem.
Uh-huh. But you didn't publish papers for until you got out.
No, there was a moment when because I decided to go out, I quit university. And for that, maybe for a couple of years, I didn't publish much.
You decided to
immigrate to Israel. Uh-huh. And for that reason, I quit university because it was easier to go from some other place. So I twice changed my job. Uh-huh. And doubling my salary, by the way, every time.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah, sure.
What did you work as?
No, first I went to the, in English it would say Weather Institute, yeah, Hydrometeorological Institute. Mm-hmm. And it was quite fun doing there because I was learning a little bit physical atmosphere and things like that and writing. My major ability was to write proposals. I was very good at writing proposals. Give me any subject, I could write a proposal. Uh-huh. And professional couldn't tell, I understood nothing about that. And so one I wrote in this institute about interaction of particle with satellites in high atmosphere using Boltzmann equation.
All right.
Yeah, and so I wrote, and this guy who was expert, of course, to check it, he wouldn't believe I didn't understand almost no word what I wrote. And then similarly, I worked called Pulp and Paper Institute. Because there were my friends, they didn't want I would immigrate from there. And so I went to another place. Mm-hmm. It was easy for me because I had a Russian name and everything. It was very easy to get a job. And so I came there to this institute just looking for position. And there was a man there just who was running some lab of computers. He talked to me and said, oh, fine, yeah, yeah. He was from the mathematical department. He knew me and brought me, you know, to these official guys who had signed papers. He signed all papers and said, when do you go? And he's nice guy. He now lives here in America. Yeah. He's a very, uh-huh. very nice fellow. Yeah. So I thought I was cheating. So it was obvious, yeah, for him. Yeah. So why I was doing that. And then I was also writing some, I think, for other kind of high-positioned men there, I was writing some proposals, yeah. Uh-huh. I forgot what exactly, but some nonsense. But it's actually fun, yeah. You take a bunch of articles, a bunch of things, and just look through them, ta-ta-ta, and then start compiling them so this sounds right, yeah, and a little bit of imagination. And nobody can tell the difference.
That's funny. How was it? Tony Phillips went to Leningrad.
Yes, he was in Russia, and we met in Leningrad, mm-hmm. and he was really well kind of understood pretty well the structure. Though he had some trouble with the authorities, I remember,
because with
he,
that?
the authorities, but I think he was, they caught he was smoking marijuana or something.
Oh, really?
So something like story like that. Yeah, he actually had to leave. And so we met, and I remember, so he's Russian, so I brought some vodka. And I was not very good at that, but he was excellent. He was drinking the whole bottle, and he was so happy. Uh-huh. So we had a really good time. He enjoyed it very much. And then he had to leave. But we communicated after that, and we talked mathematics when he was there. And that's about it, yeah. And it was very close, because I was much influenced by one of his papers he wrote prior to that paper on submersions, which I was very much actually inspired by that.
That's what started the whole thing?
Yeah, this I realized that there may be the general principle, because before it was very much tied up to this smell, kind of her stuff, and then his paper shown that it's not exactly like that, and then I realized it's true in general.
A grandiose set of theorems. Do you think they will be ever be used?
I'm saying to you many times, they're negative results. They say that you have to be, there are limitations how you think about partial differential equations. That the classical attitude and the example was by Nash destroying this classical attitude, and so I shown it's just typical situation. The equation don't behave the way you expect them. The general partial differential equation just completely useless. Mm-hmm. They just accidental concept. So it tells you have to focus on particular equation. Of course, there is no recipe how to find them, but general equation don't behave in any reasonable way. And some people now you try to apply it to the equations of elasticity theory or something, but they essentially it's constructing counter example to natural hypothesis. Mm-hmm. So it says if you are not careful, your intuition is wrong, and that's the point. So there's no, it's kind of important to know, but it's certainly not leading you anywhere except just. But it tells you don't go beyond this level, you'll be in a mess. That's essentially what it says.
So it's kind of bad news.
Yeah, it's a bad news, yeah. You have to know it, but it's bad news, yeah, when you have it. When I was proving this, I haven't thought this way. Yeah, I was very excited. You prove theorem. They look very kind of constructive and positive theorems, but they're just kind of very elaborated system of counting examples.
Do you have a set of the problems that you still think about in that direction?
Oh, yeah, still, because it's not finished. Yeah, you don't know exactly where the boundary lies, and you want to draw the line. Mm-hmm. And if you can draw the line, on one side, you will definitely say something great. On the other, you have this mess, but you have to find where the line comes. Mm-hmm. And apparently, still, most of this territory uncharted. It's much this. My conjecture goes much wider. This kind of bad. I don't know soft things, mm-hmm. but you want to know, right? That's I think in geometry, the basic dividing line. Yeah, where structure begins and where it ends, and you want to know the boundary.
And it's a line.
Yes, I think it's a line. I think it's rather sharp. The experience on this with Eliashberg when we thought about symplectic geometry, it was clear that it might be very sharp. Either if you cannot have much mixture. Yeah. However, now you would ask thing that there may be some mixture actually in symplectic geometry.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, the line may be going inside of symplectic geometry, not outside. There may be more kind of finer line than there. Uh-huh. But these lines, when they appear, they're usually very sharp. Uh-huh. Right? And that's one of the kind of underlying thing of this principle. The same as in mathematical logic, yeah, like when you prove that something algorithmically unsolvable, you usually prove much more. So there's a line, either you can do anything or nothing, sort of. And this nothing, exactly what's called mathematics, when things don't happen, uh-huh. or happens in a very particular and unpredictable way. Uh-huh. And be bad. Outline, kind of, everything is kind of trivial, so any kind of mess may happen. And I don't know truly other domains when this was well formulated. So in logic, it is...
Computer science?
Yeah, it's in PNP, I mean, this is what you... Yeah, in a way, yeah. But then you cannot prove anything. Yeah, you only know the line maybe exists, maybe not, right? Mm-hmm. So it's slightly different. Now we draw the line. Yeah, you cannot show, right? P don't equal in P or whatever.
Right.
But you were mentioning once to me that this is, in reality, this is not so relevant.
Yes, I think it's not the only way to formulate complexity problem, right? I think it's still too abstract, and there are much more basic problems which should be first addressed. Mm-hmm. Because, in real life, all algorithms are at most long linear. If it's not long linear, you're in a bad shape. Square is a huge thing, yeah. Mm-hmm. Million is a reasonable number. If it's squared, you have trillion. No.
That's so good.
Yeah, if you take billion, for example, you still can handle billions on your computer. But you take 10 to the 18, forget it. No.
Right.
So
square is a huge, huge number. And that's, I think, essentially squares is everywhere in your, you have, inside of your head, inside of your body, you all play with squares, yeah? Right, you have about a trillion cells in your body and they kind of pairwise interact, but you can't look at the interactions, even if you can handle a trillion. Mm-hmm. Like binary interactions, fundamental everywhere, and it's means square, and square is huge. And therefore, this polynomial stuff is just unrealistic. And mathematically, well, I don't, you know, I'm not certain this is the most interesting stuff. Because it's more elementary, it's much harder to formulate because it's not invariant and if you change Turing machine. Whenever it takes up polynomial, you cannot have. Therefore, you have to forfeit Turing machines and to find different class of models which will be, because you know, you don't know what it is. So the class, this is related to the ergosystems. This is actually, you want this class of model which will be stable. You know, so the log linear will be invariant for the changes of coordinates, so to speak. Mm-hmm. But this will be much more limited change for kind of languages.
Right.
The changes, and that's, well, I'm not certain such thing actually exists mathematically. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And it may be more limited. I mean, of course, it exists in some limited fashion, but whether the most general class of changes of languages is, where it survives, it's unclear. But that, I think, is, well, is how we function there.
Coming back to Tony Phillips, he sent you a letter. I really like this letter.
Yeah, right.
What did, can you tell the story?
Yes, well, it was a letter when he's speaking something, well, you have to write it down, otherwise it does make no sense, but it was apparently a mathematical letter which I couldn't understand what he was supposed to say. But then it was an encoded letter that he was inviting me to the United States, yeah.
Right.
Some homomorphism from SU to USA or something.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it was fun, yeah, it took me...
Gromomorphism,
yeah, because in Russian it's more like homomorphism. And it took me a week to decipher what he meant. Yeah, I was trying to understand mathematics and couldn't understand it. And just eventually I got it, yeah.
Uh-huh. And indeed you went out.
Yeah, and then, well, soon thereafter, actually, I went out, yeah.
You went to Italy first?
First, actually, to Austria. It was the standard route, yeah, for people, yeah, because of immigrating to Israel. First, you go to Austria, and if you want to the States, you go to Italy. And then I spent about 3 weeks in Italy.
Mm-hmm.
And it was stupid to me, I could spend the two months enjoying a holiday, but I was pressed, I thought I have to go, you know, just to America and this, so I went to America pretty fast.
But you didn't go to France at some point?
Not at that stage. Later I was visiting France a couple of times, IHS as a visitor, mm-hmm. and then I went, moved there permanently.
And how was America at first sight? This is 74, right?
74.
Yeah.
No, just it was a real surprise. Yeah, it was years going one century back. Yeah, I thought I would go going 21st century, but I moved to 19th century. Of course, at Stony Brook, and it was this pastoral life, you know, just green and just, you know, almost horses running around. I mean, not quite, but close to that.
So you heard New York, and you thought
I thought New York is New York, but it was not that kind of New York. Yeah. That was a big surprise, and people thought I should be shocked by that. Yeah, but by opposite. And the whole attitude, the buildings were made, you know, in a funny way. That was kind of difficult, how to open the windows. Yeah, that was a non-trivial thing, yeah.
Opening the windows?
Yeah, because in Europe, all windows open like that.
Right.
And in small houses in America, they open like that.
Right.
And that was, you know, not obvious. But uh-huh. This was, I think, the only problem.
What about driving?
Driving, yes, I learned, I always wanted, so I learned driving, yeah. Driving was easy, but then orienting yourself was hard, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Because the landmarks are very deceptive, like 7-11. I try to use for as a landmark.
Uh-huh.
And just be getting lost, I'm asking people, what is it? Where is 7-11? And certainly that was not the same. Yeah, that was, I remember one. These things that was funny.
You were saying the other day that giving good directions for driving is like writing a good mathematical book.
Not exactly, but being exactly saying that you can be followed, yeah. So I give very detailed instructions. And that's not trivial because you have to assume that the person who reads it understands nothing. No common assumption. For example, I was given instruction, you go west, east, whatever. So how you choose west? You look at the sky, see where is the sun? And this is how I was trying to orient myself with these instructions, yeah. And then it's just on the...
No, really? You were driving?
So, yes, exactly. How else? They say, move west after that point, yeah. So I move west and I look in the sun. Somewhere on the sign there is letter W. But I have no idea it means west, yeah? What the hell means W? And I was driving to Princeton, I remember, for the first time. It took me about 12 hours.
12 hours?
Yeah, to go to Princeton.
From Stony Brook.
From Stony Brook, exactly, uh-huh. Because this is how I was doing with the sun, and then it was a cloudy day, it was a mess, so I have to see where the shadows are, right? It was. And the people were saying, move west, I had no idea. This, but they, anyway, west is west for me. I just look at the sun, how right. I determine the, what is west, what is east. Yeah. Even now in New York, actually, when you orient on the sunny day, if you go out of subway, where, how you know where is west, east? You look at the sun.
You can look at the sun.
Otherwise, you have to go around the corner and see how the numbers change. Yeah?
That's true.
Right. But if it is sun, you look at the sun. But on the highway, it's not so easy because it doesn't quite correspond, yeah, where the axes are.
Yeah, but when they, but you're right. When people say west, they usually mean northwest or southwest.
No, but that means the sign on the highway. Yeah, what's written on the highway.
Yeah,
and that's it.
That's it.
Yeah, but so the west in this definition will be the average of the direction given by road sign or something. Yeah? If you average, maybe you get the right west.
Uh-huh.
So
if you're lucky.
If you're lucky, because the surface of the earth is not quite flat, so averaging is sticky.
Right.
So. Actually, I'm curious if it gives you the right direction, yeah?
If you average...
Yeah, look all west, turn on the rows, and just average those factors. If it will be west or not?
No. It can't be.
No, well, because by the law of large numbers, errors should cancel. If they're made more or less random, then it's okay. But if there's some bias, yeah, then it's...
That's a good question. That's a good question. You have this similar problems with definitions, right?
Well, in a way, yeah. No, that's more serious, yeah. Yes, as I said, most definition of fundamental objects, whichever mathematics or not, in which you find in writing, is put mildly is nonsense, yeah. Nonsensical.
What do you mean, nonsensical?
Well, just look at the following. You can find a textbook definition of a matrix, and it says a square table. What is a square table? Meaning, what is a square? What is a table, what is vertical, what is horizontal, not mathematical words, right? Mm-hmm. And more definition, people pretend they define something, but they say everybody knows anyway, and they just, you know, yeah, it's unclear why they say it, right? And it has absolutely no meaning and carrying no information. But easier to say what a great definition, and the great definition, you know, in mathematics, and they were like in modern time, many of them were created by Grothendieck. And they contain a new non-trivial idea. Yes, and they really have new idea, absolutely, which is not at all apparent, and they're hard to accept, yeah. All definitions of Grothendieck, when you read them, you don't want to accept them, because they're really new, yeah. And then, painfully, you accept them and see he was right. He was always, I think, almost always right in doing that. When people say, you know, that a man is a bird without feathers, you know, this famous definition, I forgot who, but it was kind of a joke, but all definitions are like that, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You have to know what is a bird, what are feathers, you have to define what are feathers, what are birds, completely irrelevant. Yeah. They're usually jokes. And the same applies to many definitions, inside and especially outside. What is mathematics? Yeah. And it's science about tarotage. Nonsense. What is science? You don't have theory of sciences. Yeah. There are only, actually, one. In any way, there is only one science, is physics. Yeah. Everything else is just, you know, imitation of physics.
Uh-huh.
Right. So what's science? So mathematics is not physics. Et cetera, et cetera.
So, but what makes a good definition, more or less?
Good idea. You need to know a highly non-trivial idea. You have to create something. For example, you discover America, and then you say, this is America. Well, you can call it West India. But you have to discover a new continent, and you describe it and give it a name. But you have to discover it first, then you give a name. But if you say, everybody knows like Lamarck was giving definition of animals compared to plants and saying that... animals react to irritation and move, and plants don't. And everybody knows that, and you can say it's a definition. It's easy, by the way, it's wrong. Right? Plants which react to, because we know how plants react to irritation and eat insects, and the animals like corals, which don't react to irritation in an obvious way. So, and this, but you're just given two groups of things. You want to put some feature which is common to them, and which everybody knows anyway, and you just pick it. It's no fun. You have to say something nobody knows. Then you give a definition, right? And then it's a definition, and it brings you far like ideas of Grothendieck schemes or, you know, topos or whatever. That's a great definitions.
Mm-hmm.
Because they come, you know, they create a few. You cannot give it easily.
But they're painful to read.
No, of course, because they're new. You have to learn something to understand them, to accept them. And they, you create a context for this definition. Each of these definitions, in order to have it, you need a context, and this is a categorical context. So once you have categorical context, then you can, in this language, express the idea. And first you create this context, and then you have this untrivial idea. And they're painful because they're new. Anything new is, you know, it's hard to reach America, I mean, by ship, so it doesn't mean there's something wrong with that, yeah? And it's easy to reach ahead, but this doesn't make a good definition. Mm-hmm. And most of them are just, you know, maybe good for librarians sometimes or whatever, but not as a true definition. This is a tremendous misconception that definition is just put anything and whatever. And mm-hmm. because I think before growth indicator was not so clear. And because you see, the algebraic geometry, and the way tried to formalize it. And he did it in a traditional way. Mm-hmm. And I learned that in the seminar by Linick. And it looks so natural and so nice. You know, you accept it immediately because it's trivial. Exactly. His definition, his idea was trivial. As a student, it was obvious to me. But you look, Grothendieck, I remember I was resisting and Kof saying, well, that's the right definition. I was resisting. It looked completely counterintuitive. But then year after year, I realized that's exactly what the reason is so good, yeah? It's not something everybody can guess. And you know, André Weil was very unhappy with Grothendieck. Mm-hmm. Because it's exactly counterintuitive. André Weil did what people were doing, Kof, just kind of express it in a systematic way. And it exists, of course, a couple of years because Grothendieck came thereafter and completely turned upside down, well, completely changed perspective. And mm-hmm. Grothendieck is the right definition. If you think about that, it is, just once you, regardless of application, it's just, then you can elaborate, but this is basic ideas of algebraic geometry expressed in this functoriality of functor of points. And this applies to everything. Definition is as, that you force this object deserves looking at, and you have to put it in a way, what it is, in the context. So you need a huge context to make a definition. So first you create this context, and this is not kind of formal, yeah? And then you can pinpoint what we do, of course, in mathematics, because we already know we have common context. And then if you go to another domain and you just assume this context, you may be very sloppy, and other people don't understand it here. Like, what is west and what the W on the exit, yeah? Right? Because definition of the West is where sun is, yeah. It's not where W is written, so to speak.
Right.
In the way.
Right.
This is, and that's not obvious if you're used to road signs, maybe not quite not clear what is West, yeah.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah, quantitative topology.
Yeah.
What were the results that inspired you to start thinking about this?
Well, actually, I learned from Buraga the theorem by Lovno and Pu about minimal geodesics in surfaces.
In surfaces?
In surfaces, yeah. Uh-huh. It was done for torus and the projective plane, yeah, and they were kind of very fine results. And then there was a related article written by Berger at that time. Uh-huh. And then I started thinking about that. Actually, probably then I started thinking about this, what is historic inequalities.
Uh-huh.
And
you were in?
In Leningrad, yeah. So these are very old papers, yeah.
Yeah.
And, so I thought and just proved something. There was some other line of development which I had done before. There were some few papers about map of sphere to sphere of degree 2 or something, how much it must dilate. I've forgotten the authors. I think one of the papers by Blaine Lawson. And then also I thought about that and realized that the Sullivan minimal model gives you kind of overall picture, which is probably still open. If it's sharp, but then I give you an estimate on the deletion of maps and given homotopy classes. And still it's open question, yeah. If it is the minimal model, give you kind of full picture.
Mm-hmm.
And then actually I appreciate it very much. Before I read this article by Sullivan, I couldn't get by the point, yeah, how to use it. It's a great theorem. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's a really great theorem.
When did you meet Sullivan?
When I came to Stony Brook, yeah. Not immediately, maybe, but maybe in the summer or something.
Are you the same age, almost?
He's slightly older, I think, a couple of years maybe older.
Uh-huh. And did you become friends quickly?
Yeah, because we're fighting a lot.
Fighting a lot?
Oh, yeah. This was very good, yeah.
You're both quite outspoken.
Yeah, it was, yeah, I mean, yes, it was very nice, yeah. I enjoyed this a lot.
Uh-huh.
Yes. Now we may be not doing this as much because we are older, but then we, in all respect, not only mathematically, or running faster or whatever.
You competed?
No, we just discussed the subject, what is trivial, what is non-trivial, what is right, what is wrong, how it should be, etc. And then it's, of course, much more, how to say it, he's much more mature than myself, always was, yeah, he kind of. But on that hand, I was always challenging and provoking him, and he was losing his temper.
And Jeff Cheeger was also...
Yeah, Jeff Cheeger was also there. And Gromov, yeah, was a geometrist. And I talked to them, of course, quite a bit, yeah.
And you wrote many papers with Jeff Cheeger. He's maybe the person you wrote
Quite a few, yeah, but it was much later, I think it was after I left Stony. At that time, because Jeff at that time was working more on analysis. In the elliptic stuff, you know, he proved this Ray Singer conjecture, and then he was developing this L2 cohomology of singular spaces. And I was far from that. I learned from him quite a bit, but I was not involved. I thought about it, but I never could prove anything. But then we kind of, later on, we came on the common ground on this collapsing stuff and cohomology of groups, whatever.
This was where? In NYU already?
No. Then I think I was in France. Then I was communicating and I was coming to Stony Brook at the time. I was coming off in the summer to Stony Brook. And then we were doing this together. But it was later, yeah. It was in Asia, yeah.
So you started thinking about these systolic inequalities around in the 70s?
Yes.
Early 70s?
Early 70s, yeah.
And you thought about it for like 10 years?
84, so I'm sorry, about 15 years, yeah, I thought about that, yeah.
Did you read this article by Larry Guth, The Metaphors in
Systolic Geometry? Yes, I read it, yeah, no, it's very well written. Actually, the article like that, very welcome, they knew you. Of course, for me, I look from inside, yeah. It's pleasant for me for personal reasons, but I think it's objectively it's very well written, yeah?
Excellent.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You read it and you enjoy the process of reading.
Yeah.
And that's very rarely done, yeah.
Yeah, he sort of did this, sort of follows one track and then he says, well, here you get stuck. And then you start this other track and then here you get stuck. Have you tried writing something like that?
Well, not exactly like that. I tried to make more kind of lovely writing. I wrote this kind of introduction to Riemannian geometry about curvature, but I don't think people kind of accepted this. Yeah, it's too simple.
The curvature and
Certainly.
Sign and the minute.
Yeah,
curvature.
I think it gives a much easier introduction to Riemannian geometry, but some people don't like it maybe for that reason. I'm joking. Yeah, it's not that I mean seriously, but. There is a tradition, and it's unclear when you try to break it, if indeed it is only because of the tradition still remains, or because indeed what you attempt for some reason is unsatisfactory. But typically, a particular attempt may be unsatisfactory. But if there is traditional thing going textbook for textbook for 50 years, it's certainly something wrong with this. And we see this great example with algebraic geometry. You just poop, you change it, and this. It actually keeps changing. They're very dynamic, yeah, in this field. Because if foundation are not right, you don't know what to do. In some domains, people are not so much concerned with foundation. They think this is fine without that, but that's a wrong attitude.
You don't know what to do in terms of where to go?
Yeah, of course, growth and deep kind of foundation orient you. You know kind of where to go, what to develop, and just give fantastic, and people just following that, and just huge thing happen.
So this is sort of what happened to you when you decided to do metric geometry without smoothness conditions?
This was tradition in Russia. It was Alexandrov school. They were always doing that. But I think for me, there were two reasons. One is that when you work with just with smooth Riemannian manifolds, you don't use smoothness. You don't use curvature. You use only certain properties, and these properties you can kind of either accept as axioms or easily prove them without any computation, and then you do it purely geometrically. And this what this guy was doing. Another point is that in Alexandrov school, him and his kind of students, they always try to prove that these singular spaces are very much like regular spaces. And there's very much effort was spent on that. But it is not so. And so on one hand, for Riemannian geometry, it's a material that's smooth or not. But then there are other kind of categories, and this were significance was seen in the work of Breuer and Titz on buildings, where this all this negative curvature essentially appears in slightly different names, and they are singular. And then this was another kind of line of thought which I was pursuing, and that this...
These cut spaces.
Yeah, these cut spaces. Alexandrov introduced them for completely opposite purpose. He introduced them actually to single out kind of smooth manifolds with certain properties. But the whole point is they not single them out. There are much more, and they were making all the effort to exclude it. But on the contrary, you have to include it and then become real fun. You have a really good theory which give you a completely different perspective. Uh-huh. And these singular spaces usually are not regular. They are absolutely far from regular. And they, but still they, and so this axiomatic, for example, for positive curvature, it is true. The singular positive curvature spaces are more or less like smooth ones. Uh-huh. And this was essentially brought to the full fruition by Perelman. But the negative curvature is opposite, completely opposite. The smooth are exceptions. Mm-hmm. But the theory goes anyway and goes quite far. And it has a much, really has examples and which you can dream of in the Riemannian geometry.
So how did you realize that there were these examples? So you took this Titz world and this geometry world and you sort of...
It was hard to say, just don't think and then you think and you realize there is an example. I was trying to understand this Titz example in this framework. And I tried actually several definitions. Competing definition by Busemann, what means positive negative curvature. But Busemann also had the same perspective with Alexandrov, trying to show the singularities are not there. Mm-hmm. If you add some little condition, they disappear. Right? And I was trying to make the right definition, just make it right. Mm-hmm. Then there was a good paper by Klingenberg, who observed that manifolds of negative curvature, even if you change the metric, the geometry of universal covering doesn't change much. Mm-hmm. And the paper, I read it, but I had the first very negative impression because the main theorem there is wrong. He had wanted to prove a theorem, and then he just make all possible mistakes, which is okay. You know. Mm-hmm. There was a classical theorem due to Morse about oriented Riemann surfaces. Mm-hmm. And Klingenberg generalizes that. And just it's false, either it's non-oriented or it's dimensionally bigger than 2. There are obvious counterexamples. Mm-hmm. However, yes. All this preparation he made, they kind of go to nothing. I absorbed them and they were quite, they're kind of simple, but they give certain orientation. Mm-hmm. Right? And this was paper that kind of was rather interesting in this respect. But on the other hand, when I read it, it was nonsense. Mm-hmm. This his kind of foundational part kind of obvious, and then conclusion is wrong. However obvious, it was conceptually quite significant. Mm-hmm. Which, not, but his result was not true.
You had the definition of hyperbolic groups for a while, right?
Yes. This under the influence of the paper by Klingenberg, and I just realized this abstract concept. But I thought for many years that you can prove they have kind of singular negative curvature in some sense. And so I wasn't writing anything. I was trying to prove this. So my conjecture was that given any hyperbolic groups, it acts on some space of singular space of negative curvature. And if you could prove it, you don't have to develop the whole theory. It would be just everything would follow. But I couldn't prove it, still I cannot prove it. Uh-huh. And it still remains unknown. But, well, in some moment I surrendered and just made the theory. And it's a little bit heavy because you carry all these constants, yeah. Uh-huh. Otherwise, all would be zero. Uh-huh. And then you have to keep track of them. I hated to do that, but eventually I think it was Gernstein who convinced me to write it down.
Uh-huh. And Jim Cannon was doing something kind of similar,
he was
right?
Doing something similar, yeah.
Did you ever meet him?
Oh, yeah, sure, yeah, we communicated, you know, yeah.
And? Did you ever collaborate with him? Or?
No, we talked, yeah, but I don't think we collaborated, yeah. Uh-huh. He was much more kind of... he made this very nice point, which I actually overlooked, that the zeta function of the... zeta function of manifold negative curvature, constant negative curvature, but it's true in general, is rational. Oh. And it's very surprising when you think about that, but this conjecture of Thurston. Mm-hmm. So I remember just saying... found this paper, I couldn't believe it, but then I realized I kind of knew that. But I never realized it is that, yeah, because you have the picture and it's kind of obvious in this general picture. But you just to say it, it was kind of a very brilliant point by Thurston and proven by Cannon. Mm-hmm. But so we more or less going along the same lines, yeah.
What year is this?
I think it might be 87 hyperbolic groups.
Oh, okay.
So about 3-4 years later. Mm-hmm. But this again, just for me, it was just, you know, yes, not very exciting to write it. I knew this for 10 years, yeah. And I just, because I couldn't prove the theorem, so I just wrote it.
What you could prove?
Yeah. So I knew that you make parallel theory and I knew how to do that, but I also it was very annoying that you had to do it, all these technicalities. Uh-huh. And it was a bore in a way to write. Uh-huh. Right? Because you think you're missing the main point. And I'm not certain, yeah, whether it's true or not. Yeah. It was still completely unnecessary with this simple argument, and probably it's not true.
A couple of years ago, you proved a topological version of Bárány's theorem.
Yes.
And the proof is kind of inspired by your old proof of the systolic inequality.
It's related to that, yeah, one of the intermediate inequalities, yes.
Right. But the paper is written very categorically.
Yes.
And the question is, did you think about the proof sort of geometrically? Or
no, of course I thought of this geometrically, but once I had this idea, I realized that it should be algebraic. Uh-huh. So that's what you taught me, I think. Geometrically, I just had the geometric picture in mind, but when I tried to formalize it in this geometric term, it became a little bit unpleasant. And then I realized that these isoperimetric inequalities or federal framing or whatever, systolic inequalities, have purely algebraic formulation. They make sense in algebra, and then they're tremendously more general. Mm-hmm. They cover much more examples. Mm-hmm. And once it was said, yeah, it just was very easy, of course, to write the proof. Mm-hmm. But and you see, this also includes other kind of questions. On this language, you can formulate these questions of Turing graphs, yeah, I mentioned there. Though mm-hmm. this form is still unknown, the way I formulated this question of Turing graph. It's very similar to the Turing graph in terms of the G operator in these complexes, the norm of this operator, how it behaves.
You mean whether the Turing graph has a Bárány constant, positive
Bárány? No, not Bárány constant. There is this question recently solved by the problem by Turing about Turing graph solved by Rasborov and some other Russian about Turing graph, that the graphs which have minimal with given cardinality having minimal cliques, yeah, or something. Mm. And they are just union of cliques or something. This is, and the interesting point that we look at the density of this graph, the function is piecewise rational. Mm. So in terms of, so this is some kind of function, naturally coming function, and you know it points 1 over n, you easily can compute it, but in between you have to interpolate. And this, at each moment, the different rational function is still of bounded degree. Mm. And this is, the guy's recently proven. But their formulation is how hard to remember. You have to know a Turing graph. But in this language, you just have some operator, and it's just kind of a norm of this operator, how it behaves in this chain complex. So it gives you a certain perspective on many combinatorial questions once you do it. Mm-hmm. And of course, with Bárány, you still don't know the right constant, the asymptotics. Yeah, that's very annoying. Yeah. Of course, I tried to prove it for quite a while. That's something different. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's certainly quite difficult.
In many of these examples that we were talking about, sort of the key point was that you brought together ideas from different fields.
Definitely. No, that's the thing, is neat when thing happens, yeah, I'm really excited, yeah, and it's your square kind of, something squares, yeah, uh-huh. in the right direction.
Obviously, that takes some talent, but it also takes some attitude. Do you think, like, the mathematical community should try more to find bridges?
No, there are a number of bridges, of course, limited. Of course, you want to have some unity. And we search for unity in mathematics all the time, yeah, on one hand. And these bridges are rare, right? Maybe not so rare. That's actually not so clear. Mm-hmm. And you have to do everything. I mean, just you
to have bridges, first you have to have a kind of rivers, yeah, or sort of continents. Right. You have to build them, and then you have bridges. Yeah, you need both. Yeah, you cannot have only bridges.
What are your favorite bridges from the last, say, 50 years, then from the last 10
no,
years?
No, I have about 5 papers like that, yeah, which indeed I found some bridges. So of course, this is my work of holomorphic curves, which I think the most interesting, where you relate complex analysis and solve to symplectic geometry, where the most, it's like Donaldson style thing. Yeah, of course, Donaldson is the most interesting, most significant instance of such a bridge, yeah, to a new continent.
Why?
In Donaldson theory, right? It's that you make an analytic bridge from to topology, mm-hmm. and it's completely new world discovered. And more recently, this was SLE.
SLE by
yes,
Schramm?
Yeah, that's another discovery. Oh, in the recent years, Elusive were great discoveries. And there are these bridges. And exactly because they're so spectacular. You make little bridge and the huge new thing comes. Yeah, of course, you can build the same thing like Groth and Dick without any bridge. You just build and build and build and build even bigger, right? But this is more exciting because whoop, whoop, and then things come out of nowhere, sort of, just because there is a bridge, uh-huh. right? Of course, you cannot do this only with bridges. Yeah, you have to, you have to have a substance from which you build the bridge.
Right.
But these are more explosive phenomena which we see in mathematics. Yeah, these two again in the recent years. At least which I understand. Of course, many things probably happen which I don't understand.
When did you start thinking about symplectic geometry?
Back in the 80s. Mm-hmm. Yeah, certainly in the 80s. Because I remember Fuchs came to Leningrad, Niemann Fuchs, and gave a lecture. And he spoke about these conjectures by Arnold. Mm-hmm. And then I tried to disprove them all. And some partly kind of proved something which is opposite to these conjectures. And then Mr. Eliashberg much spoke about that. And I kind of realized there is a conjectural borderline, either this or that, and Eliashberg was oscillating between what is true and also, I was always on the side that there shouldn't be any theory, basically on the principle of these guys like Carnot and they said nothing here because it's trivial conjectures, of course, cannot be true, mm-hmm. right? And so I was trying to make counting example, Yasha first also, but then there was, I think he realized this paper, last paper by Poincaré, and unlike Arnold Poincaré was more respectable, and so I started thinking about that, and then he proved some results in the spirit of Arnold conjectures. And eventually he moved further, but then he had problems. You know, he was kicked out of Leningrad, and he couldn't find a job, and so his problem was publishing. But eventually he kind of realized there is this rigidity theory, and then Arnold conjecture for Torres was proven by Conley and Zender, and using this Rabinowitz idea. Which actually, I didn't know. This was a very great idea for Rabinowitz, by the way. Yeah. This variational principle, which is actually Maupertuis principle properly understood, yeah, which I missed.
Which is what?
It's Maupertuis least action principle, how it's actually what it means in Hamiltonian mechanics. And it was not clear before Rabinowitz. And somehow I missed these papers. I didn't realize the significance. I heard of them, but never realized how it was a very profound idea there. And then there was this variational approach. And then this was this thing with holomorphic curves, yeah. So I thought about this in and out for a long time, but.
You told me once a little bit about the details of the discovery.
Yeah.
So you were reading Pogorelov.
Yes, I really reading some book by Pogorelov on rigidity of surfaces, mm-hmm. which I couldn't understand because.
Convex geometry.
Convex surfaces, yeah. Mm-hmm. And he was referring to the theory of I keep forgetting how they're called, quasi-analytic functions, which were developed in the West by Lippmann-Burst and by Vekua in Russia. And I couldn't understand what he was saying, and then I looked at these articles, I also couldn't understand what they're saying. And then I understand in one book the formula when Burst writes some, you know, two-line formula to say that some vectors give positive orientation. And then I thought that I can do it myself, and then I understood what it was. And then I realized the theory. And I was very happy, of course, with that. And what's funny, by the way, when I came with this, I was absolutely certain that was the kind of the best thing I ever done in my life. And then I was giving lectures in various places, and people asked me, why are you doing that? Maybe it's difficult, but who cares? And several times, given in different places, lecture. This was actually, this was surprised me tremendously. Mm-hmm. I think it was obviously kind of really kind of great stuff, the best ever, because I was doing lectures on much more trivial subject than being kind of well taken. But this, people just really refused to understand. Yeah? Though mm-hmm. it was very simple and just, and that's I found strange. The same, by the way, I must say, the same was true actually with some reaction of people on Donaldson. And you see the Donaldson, fantastic new stuff, new world images, but not everybody reacted this way.
Mm-hmm.
Right, that's, I think, is a, this, I found it kind of strange. Yeah. I thought you would react, well, when you see something like that, everybody reacts the same way, but no.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember many kind of very great mathematicians make very critical remark about Donaldson, and obviously wrong. I compared them to other results. It was clear it was the, when it came, it was the best just for many years and probably in the century. And they say, oh, no, well, it's very special, and it's not new ideas, or ta-ta-ta-ta.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's it was unbelievable.
There's this famous line from Lagrange. You know this line?
Yes.
That he wrote in his book?
Right.
Saying, I didn't use any geometry, basically.
Yes.
And now pseudo-holomorphic curves come to take somehow his ideas and completely change the
landscape. No, well, it's not quite his ideas. Yeah, I would, somewhat different about, you know, about this good saying by Arnold that mm-hmm. mathematics between Newton and Poincaré is dessert covered by formulas.
Is what?
Dessert covered by formulas. Right, like Lagrange thing, yeah. Because people were priding themselves writing formulas, but at that time it was the only way to be kind of rigorous, yeah. And uh-huh. they were afraid of kind of hand waving because there were no kind of formalism to make it adequate, right? So uh-huh. and I don't know how Lagrange taught him what he was kind of thinking. Of course, he could be a very algebraic man, like Jacobi, yeah, which we know was competing with Abel, and just you see Abel was thinking dramatically and Jacobi more algebraically, and you can see clearly difference. About Lagrange, I'm not certain, and I never read to Lagrange himself, yeah, so, but, of course, in the case of homomorphic curve, that was obvious, yeah, just some of the people do it in analysis, but they just had no picture, and they just, they proved, you know, very good theorems, but they couldn't understand their meaning. They were kind of pointless, yeah. Mm-hmm. In a way, you even cannot use them there because we're not exactly right, yeah. Because and but technically, this all everything was known, technically speaking, in a way, almost, yeah. But it was not put into the right context, mm-hmm. right? I think every kind of mathematical idea or technicality, that two parts, there's technical part and then where it leaves, yeah. You know, you make a bug, but then you have to give it where it must leave, yeah. And mm-hmm. the boars are important, yeah. You know, beautiful animal, but it starves because there is no food. And making this kind of garden is kind of trivial, but you have to make it with the right kind of food, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mathematics like that, this idea crawling, and they have something to eat. And bug, by the way, you know, yeah, I mentioned this bug, you know, very mathematical, you know that, yeah.
Bugs?
Oh, yeah. If you put bugs on the leaf, yeah, there's a lot of mathematics in there. There is some group theory in its behavior, yeah.
Like what?
The way your eye works and the bugs works, it's the same principle. This it's related to Ergosystems, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you look at something at here in the room, yeah, your eye spends unproportionately long time on the edges, on the boundaries of the domains.
Okay.
You can, you know, it's not obvious, but you have to really look, make visualize, look how your eyes move. You know, boo, 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 boo. But very high, probabilistically, it would spend more than half time on this set of almost measure zero, and at the corners it spends also a lot of time. The same about bugs. If you look a bug on the leaf, on a leaf, yeah, it will not spend much time inside. It will crawl around the edge, and then when it goes to the vertex, spend that time more, for the same universal reason.
When it goes to the what?
On the tip of the leaf, yeah, it will spend there more time, by far more time than the kind of the area of this region would suggest, yeah. And just from point of view, like a system, there is a mechanism which explains both whether your eye moves and not moves, and there's some simple mathematics involved, and some little group theory involved, mm-hmm. and bugs or no, some group theory.
Mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm saying this. Metaphors may be not completely meaningless, yeah. That ideas crawls like bugs, yeah. It's not because our logic everywhere follow a few simple principles which we share with animals, even with insects. Because there are so few choices, that's the point. Not because bugs are smart, because we are stupid.
People often mention your name around Brabant's proof of the geometrization and of the Poincaré conjecture.
Yeah.
Because sort of the context, it's very important to the context, is Gromov house of convergence.
For me, it was never like that, and I don't think for Perelman either. The difficulty was, were very different, in a different direction. Uh-huh. That was a kind of common knowledge, yeah. Just this kind of geometric ideas, they were already common knowledge. You wouldn't think about them as something significant. Yeah, it was kind of obvious, yeah. And no, actually, it was known in a way to geometers before me. It was not articulated properly. Yeah, there were examples of these conversions and et cetera, but they were not articulated. I just articulated this in this context. And it was articulated in group theory. And then you have partial differential equation you have to understand. That was the point. This was helpful. This was giving you certain orientation, but this was minor point, yeah. Mm-hmm. This was of course, well, probably directing you a little bit, but it was a little drift of air, yeah. And there was a whoop, you have to go uphill, yeah. Anyway, it was refreshing having this, but yeah, you have to climb up regardless of that. What Perelman did, yeah.
He writes his papers in every dimension.
Yes.
But there are theorems saying that there is no hope for geometrization in higher dimensions.
That's certainly true, yeah. There is no hope for geometrization, but still there may be hope for a good geometric theory. Geometrization is very, very kind of particular conjecture for property for dimension three. Mm-hmm. But in high dimension, there may be something else. And possibly this equation may direct you toward the geometric theory of certain kind of objects, mm-hmm. which may be not spaces in a naive sense, but something. Mm-hmm. So I see one point is that you cannot geometrize manifold, but you can geometrize something more, some coarser objects, some equivalence classes in a way, yeah. But we don't know what they are. And yeah, that's a possibility. I mean, of course, there is no, there's some indication it may be true, but we don't know. Mm-hmm. So you can make some kind of conjecture of this type, but have some vague conjectures, yeah, of this type. So these hyperbolic manifolds, say hyperbolic ones, are the geometric implementational groups, right? And the canonical thing associated to groups. And this may be true for high dimension as well, because there are other instances of high dimensional groups which have canonical geometric implementations, namely, say, all group of symmetric spaces. And they just come from groups. Just knowing the group, you can reconstruct the space. Mm-hmm. The question, if you can, so what happens in a certain degree of generality? And that's an interesting question. And this method may be of relevance, but I don't think in the way it is, yeah. You have to put it in more in a new context, mm-hmm. which we don't know which one. And some of the technical lemmas he proven may turn out useful. And so he was just following the logic of this argument, and this logic suggests that, and so he wrote this quite justifiably. It may be useful for in the next step.
Why are Carnot-Carathéodory spaces called Carnot-Carathéodory?
Actually, I picked it up, not exactly this name, but this idea from an article by, I think, by Born, when he discusses this paper of Carathéodory, of foundation of classical thermodynamics. Mm-hmm. So Carathéodory just realized many things in classical thermodynamics, Carnot cycles, you follow some contact form, mm-hmm. contact form around tangentially this form. Or transversely to the form in some direction, it still can come back or don't come back, whatever. And then it's implicit in the Carnot cycle also. This is what I call it. Mm-hmm. And then people were proving this theorem that you can join any two points by this line tangent to this. It was proven several times by different authors. Actually, one of them was Smale, yeah? And independently. Mm-hmm. So there was no name to attach. I think the Carnot-Carathéodory was the Carathéodory was certainly the most, obviously, had this picture.
And what are your favorite results in that direction?
Yeah, this is a recent theorem by Robert Young,
that you prove this feather framing type inequalities for the spaces. Yeah. And this is a very beautiful result, very simply stated and quite non-trivial, and has a chemical application to group theory.
Mm-hmm.
It's just this what's called higher than functions or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a very good thing. And this is how I learned about him. I found the internet, his paper, and just I was very excited. Yeah. And then he was actually doing some mathematical, but not mathematical, some biology for a while. He was, you know, he was participating in a few projects on biology. He's a very smart fellow. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Pierre Panzu also has some nice results.
Yeah, this was old, so I'm less excited. Yeah, it was a long time ago. I suddenly probably was excited at that time, but not anymore because it's already for too long. Yeah,
uh-huh.
Pierre, yeah, he proven with these rigidities of quaternionic spaces and where this geometry also enters.
You met him when he was quite young, right?
Yes.
But still, he was an undergrad, but he decided to take the notes for your course.
Yeah, I don't know exactly, because it was everything was directed by Marcel Berger.
Uh-huh.
And he, I think, assigned Panzu be making notes from this course I was making, and he and somebody else making these notes. And then, of course, I was communicating with Pierre, and you know, so he was doing mathematics for a while, being kind of my student. Actually, officially, I think he was always doing of Berger, but he solved this question on kind of it was first instance of non-Euclidean isobermetric inequality, this for Heisenberg group, is what he proved, using this Carnot geometry.
He says, he told me a story that you were lecturing and he was taking notes and this was supposed to become a book, and he would come to ask you questions.
Yeah.
And then there was one simple question that he couldn't understand the explanation. And that most open problems came when you got frustrated with explaining this. You just started saying, oh, but you can also think about this and that and that and that and that.
Yeah, that's what I remember. He was coming, yeah.
Yeah, and there was one lemma that he couldn't understand the proof of. And then you would try to explain it, and then you would decide to stop explaining it and just start coming up with problems.
Explanatory inequality was a problem. It was never a stated question. So. And which he solved. But inside of the book, I don't think there were any, except there were some kind of confusion sometimes, because the main definition is something sup and something inf. And you never remember where you put the inequality. And the first there is some conjecture that it is the wrong sign of inequality, and then people just decided to me, oh, to buy my count example to my conjecture,
mm-hmm.
because some inequality was put out, no, you know, kind of obviously in the wrong sign.
Uh-huh,
actually, even recently, some people say, well, I made such and such conjecture. And then you count the example because somewhere some inequality in the course of conversation, whatever, got reversed.
Uh-huh.
When obviously the conjecture should be what it should be, right?
Right.
That's kind of funny. Besides, yeah, I mentioned this too many times. Inequality is very ambiguous thing. Yeah, you cannot mathematically define what is inequality.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's like saying what is a matrix, what is a square, what is up and what is down. And this problem built into a conception of order. There is not mathematical rigorous way to define what is mean A bigger than B. It depends how you write them on the blackboard, who is to the left, who is to the right. If you don't know that, you cannot explain it.
Uh-huh.
Yes. And then this also was mentioned, so with smells, if you only had smells at your disposal, you wouldn't have vision, hearing, or touch.
Yeah.
You could not say what it means A greater than B.
If you only had smell.
Right. You can say two things are similar or equal, but you cannot say one bigger than another. In this language, you wouldn't express it. And right cow, you could say it, yeah. If you have no perception of direction. You can have different smell, you can communicate sequences of smells, but you don't perceive them temporally. They only come all simultaneously. And then how you say A greater than B, how you can tell difference from B greater than A, right? Because they're not ordered already, A and B,
right?
You see? And so people who insist in mathematical rigor, sometimes kind of like logicians, it's kind of laughable, because what they write depends on what happens on the paper, which is completely definition of this will take mathematics, whoop, right? All the geometry of the plane, all the symbols, orthogonal group, all sits inside of this mathematical logic. Right? How can they be rigorous?
Right.
Right?
That's cool. Did you get any mathematical dream that you never quite accomplished, but...
Oh, quite a lot. I mean, just anything you do till the point you just cannot prove it. There's anything you want to prove, and then you cannot prove it.
But one that is kind of a...
One which I started thinking most, a very long time ago, this is this Ramsey-type theorems. Uh-huh. I always was trying to find kind of a nice conceptual approach to that. I was thinking for this. Because there was a book which I first read when I was probably quite young by Hitchin. It's called Three Germs of Number Theory. Mm-hmm. And it's an extremely annoying book because it's meant to young people to encourage them doing mathematics. Right. And he says, you read this, may be difficult for you to read, but this is exactly the kind of difficulties you have to overcome to become a mathematician. And the first of them is a proof of Van der Waerden theorem. Mm-hmm. And just first page of this notation, I couldn't swallow. A, B, C, G, ka, pa, 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 boop. And then I felt very, of course, discouraged, so you cannot do mathematics. Mm-hmm. Of course, it was just, he was a very poor writer. And I thought about this for about a year, and then I kind of found the proof of the theorem, and then I just wrote the usual proof, of course.
Just pigeonhole principle and...
Well, no, this is how it's called, the somebody's lemma, you know, this induction, and this is... Mm-hmm. You know, it's kind of simple once you know it. You can make a picture in a way. Once you see it, it's obvious. But express it, I just realize it's difficult.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's very difficult to write it down. There is some good reason why it's difficult to write it down, yeah, because it's not a recursive function, and it's a really subtle kind of induction. Involved. Uh-huh. But once you have a picture, it's just kind of obvious if you have to guess it. And then I was thinking what is called now Semeregi theorem. I thought, well, it must follow, then I couldn't prove it. And then I learned about Ramsey and Dvoretsky, and I just wanted to find a unified theory, and still I couldn't find it. Uh-huh. And it's unclear if it exists or not.
So this is the ergodic method?
No. I don't think it's it doesn't cover many cases. It doesn't cover Ramsey theorem. It doesn't cover Rabli-Dvoretsky type theorem. Uh-huh. Yeah, I don't think it's right. Because, and then certainly it doesn't give you the right estimates, yeah. Okay. It doesn't give you the right estimates.
It doesn't give you estimates.
And it doesn't use the full symmetry. Because one characteristic thing about the Semeregi, whatever, it's symmetric under any kind of group you want. You can make it symmetric under a solvable group, under, SLNP, whatever. You can make it formulate symmetrically all these ways. And then people start some particular symmetry, and that's with Fourier analysis and this particular symmetry, and of course, reason. Theory and they're very successful. However, it's kind of silly. Yeah? You have to use the full kind of the full thing, right? And nobody knows how to do that, mm-hmm. right? And I think well, just it's such a great statement, yeah. And you expect a good solution. Mm-hmm. But this was my first problem actually. I thought, and still I don't know how to solve it.
And you thought about Dvoretsky, or you thought about Dvoretsky?
Well, I started with Van der Waerden, I would say, and I just was starting from 1960, and everything. Well, now I have no chance yet to solve it. But I was returning to it from time to time. Uh-huh. Dvoretsky, of course, very much excited me because I already understood that, and then there was another statement of the same nature. And for Dvoretsky, you kind of almost can do it by topology, by kind of from almost. To derive it from general principles, and still I don't know even what the right formulation of the theorem is. I doubt you know even how to formulate them properly. Once we formulate them, maybe we'll be able to prove them. Actually, recently I have some unfinished paper when I try to formulate it in terms of as a momentum problem. You know, this classical momentum problem, and this is a kind of more sophisticated kind of momentum problem. And I don't know whether it's relevant or not. It has some built-in functoriality which I try to exploit, but I stopped writing. I couldn't again prove what I wanted. Mm-hmm. But that's, I think, is a very challenging. Maybe it's just silly. Maybe there's nothing in there. Maybe it's an accidental and no structure. But it would be very disappointing. Uh-huh. And actually, you know, it goes back to actually the main author is not Van der Waerden, not Ramsey, but Schur.
Yeah.
It's a Isaiah Schur who conjectured it. And that's, I think, is a great step. Want to have his conjecture, proving this, you know, yes. I know in it was a standard kind of a problem given to students at the university, like Van der Waerden theorem. Well, you don't solve it on a spot, but you think about several days, weeks, or we took about a year, but everybody proves it, right? It's easy kind of to prove it, but to conjecture it, it's remarkable. Also like Ramsey theorem, once you conjecture it, you prove it. Dvoretsky is slightly more subtle, but still. But the fact it was first this idea, I think, coming from Isaiah Schur, uh-huh. who conjectured it. Because, you know, he proven some little theorem of this nature about adding, subtracting numbers, whatever, it's geometrical numbers. Sorry. And there may be something in there, who knows?
Uh-huh.
But we still don't know.
What is your favorite conjecture or open problem in mathematical biology?
Again, I was saying this to you, the main problem in mathematical biology, what is the main, any problem in mathematical biology? We cannot formulate problems there, that's the problem. Uh-huh. Right? Even in physics, we can formulate good mathematical questions. Usually they're either trivial or kind of impossible to solve. Uh-huh. Or very vague, yeah, yes, if you look for the foundation of statistical mechanics. And in principle, everything is explained by Boltzmann and physics accepted. But you try to formalize it. First, you don't exactly know how to formulate it. And whichever you can formulate, you're absolutely beyond what we can prove. Yeah? It's not like stupid ergodicity or whatever. It's really very subtle geometric theorem you have to prove. And you don't have no idea. And biology is even worse than that. Right? We cannot formulate problems. And in around biology, I think is a good yet vague problem is, you know, there is a von Neumann theorem of self-reproducing automata. Uh-huh. You know this, yeah? Von Neumann proven constructed self-reproducing automata, uh-huh. Actually universal constructor. And there is a construction. He gives a model, ta-ta-ta. The question, what is the theorem? because in any definition of automata, there is no way to say it is reproducing itself, right? You know, how automata is defined. What is automaton? In what sense? And this is, I think, an interesting question, which may be, you know, may go far if you try to get many development of this, right? And this is, of course, very nice theorem of phenomenon, except it's unclear what he proves. Uh-huh. And there's something interesting about that. There's definite theorem, there's definite proof, but it's unclear what he proves. You know, you kind of know heuristically what he proves. The theorem proves it there, but there is no statement. Right? If you make statement, it will be extremely artificial. This reminds me of another problem, you know, in robotics. There is the following discussion, yeah, in philosophy of artificial intelligence. You know, there is this problem, you have a man who have to cross the river in a boat and transport, you had a cabbage, a goat, and a wolf. You have to move them.
He has to cross a river?
Yeah, in a boat, and only one object maybe in him simultaneously. Yeah?
Okay.
And so he have to bring across the river a goat, a wolf, and a cabbage, and obviously which combination are impossible, right? You cannot live alone. Yeah, it's two kind of pairs. How to do that?
I don't know.
No. Well, you don't know a solution? No, but there is a kind of obvious child kindergarten solution. So you go back and forth. You transport first, you take the goat, move it there, then you go there, and then exchange them, et cetera, et cetera. Uh-huh. However, imagine you give this problem to computer. So uh-huh. Imagine you give me this problem.
Okay.
So you ask me how you do that.
How would you do that?
I kill the wolf and bring them across the river, and there is no problem. So what's wrong with that? Was in the condition must be alive? Right? Okay, so you say, make it alive.
Okay,
well, I go around, there's a bridge across the river, and cross the bridge. Did you say there was no bridge?
There is no bridge.
You didn't mention. And so it will be forever. I will find a solution. And then they say, but how you do this? You suggest your solution. No, I say, you cannot do it. Because in the river there are some stones, you'll break your thing and you die. You didn't say there is no stone there, and you can go forever. Because you make all these assumptions. All the time, we're not aware of them, and that's a big problem in artificial intelligence, and this is what Ergosystems is supposed to overcome. How to work in this kind of vague environment.
Uh-huh.
And the same is kind of phenomenal theorem. We have lots of assumptions, and we have to live with this. We cannot kind of formalize it, yeah. But we can make programs which would not notice them, so to speak, as we don't notice them.
Ah.
Right? You see?
But you don't quite know how to do it. Yeah.
Well, I have a rough scheme, but you see, maybe it's implementable already computationally. I thought about some programs, but I cannot formalize them mathematically. It's not my business making programs, right? I thought about particular programs which can do particular things, and I thought specifically about kind of things like automatic translation or whatever. How, from this general principle, to make an automatic translation program. She doesn't know anything about languages, yeah. Mm-hmm. You see, so, whereas, you just shown strings in one language, string in another language, nothing of grammar. And it devised translation algorithm. And so, interestingly, then I spoke to people in mathematics and linguistics. It stuck exactly where they stuck with all these kind of developed techniques, yeah. Where how you assign pronouns to nouns. How is associate nouns and pronouns. You can do jokes, you can do lots of things, yeah, that's easy. But noun and pronouns is very tricky.
Nouns and pronouns?
No, the particular pronoun is shared with the particular noun in the sentence. Mm. This is his car, whatever. How you know he refers to the person who was mentioned in the previous sentence. And that is extremely subtle. And that's one of the point of the human language, very different from kind of, because it has this internal, it's, you know, it's, it, you cannot externally formalize it. And you cannot do it by kind of this simple, this simplistic algorithm which I have in mind, universal. They do anything, they do usual mathematical linguistic day. They work as well, and now more or less people do think very similar.
Oh, you were telling me that Feynman learned one thing from mathematicians.
You know, Feynman was very disrespectful to mathematicians. And in his book, you know, Surely You're Joking, Mr. Feynman, he gives some example of his talking to mathematicians there. Uh-huh. And I must say, he was completely right. Yeah, mathematicians, they are very narrow-minded, and he didn't have a chance to speak to, you know, somebody his equal. But on the other hand, he said that there was one mathematician from whom he learned one very important thing in life, uh-huh. and this was von Neumann. Uh-huh. And what he learned is how to be responsible. Uh-huh. And I think it's, in a way, it's important both for physicists and mathematicians. Yeah, if you're very responsible, and here's some example, these days is Simon Donaldson. Uh-huh. He's very responsible. It's horrible for his work, yeah, because he spends a lot of time with his students, and he just loses his time and just doesn't do as much as he could, I guess, yeah.
But it's nice to spend time with...
Yeah, but if you, you know, he has, but on the average, 10 graduate students a year.
Thing.
Yeah, people come to him, of course, and he's just a nice guy, and he takes them. He's really, no, really good person, and that's horrible for him. He's a really good person.
Well, maybe he likes
students. No, I don't think he likes students. He's just a good person. He's kind, and just he cannot say no.
Uh-huh.
This was a kind of joke said about Leo Tolstoy, yeah?
Uh-huh.
His brother was as gifted a writer as his, but he didn't have the vices necessary for a good writer. That's to say about scientists, yeah, I have some vices.
If I come to you and I want to be your student, what are my chances of getting in?
No, so far it was never a problem, never many people coming to me.
Really?
Yeah, so, and I was taking everybody.
Why? That's very strange.
Well, because in Bure we don't have the graduate school. So it's my arrangement with somebody, so the guy or the girl must be somebody else student, and formally attached to me.
These you got many from Pierre Pansua.
Yeah, from Pierre, right. Quite a few of them I got from Pierre, and I was quite happy with them, yeah.
You enjoy?
Yeah, no, I could, yeah, in certain amount. Yeah. Up to some point, probably, if you have 10 of them, and you have to really think and give a problem to all of them, they become, you know, some might be good at that. I wouldn't feel comfortable. Like Donaldson doing this very well.
As a community, this is what sort of makes us, right?
Yeah, absolutely. It's necessary. On the other hand, when you got to do mathematical, you don't want to do anything else, yeah? Students and not students. And what's Feynman had in mind, yeah, you just, you internally must be somewhat relaxed, yeah? And if you haven't feel obliged to this or that or this, it's, you know, there's also a joke about Poincaré, slightly different, that Mitta Gleffler came to talk to Poincaré. Mm-hmm. And he, in the arrangement, and he went to his apartment, was waiting in some room. He was waiting, nobody coming. Sometime Poincaré looked from his study at the guy and goes back. And this was going for several hours. Eventually Poincaré looks out, can't get out, you irritate me here, yeah? Yeah, it was. Cannot concentrate, yeah, so. I don't know, this is probably a joke, but that's very typical, right? And this is how you may feel easily.
So. Have you been a bad boy because an idea comes to you?
What do you mean?
Well, you know, when you do mathematics, you're thinking all the time, yeah. But sometimes you're thinking more.
Well, it happened to me once. I was going from Germany with somebody. Actually, I forgot the name of the person he was doing, you know, Buryakin's building. I know, actually, his work, but I forgot his name. And we went together to the train, and because I was smoking at the time, and he went to me together with me. It was horrible smoke. He was sitting there, and I said no word because I was thinking about something I just could not do otherwise.
So you used to smoke?
Yeah, I used to smoke. I smoked a lot, yeah.
A lot?
Well, you just pack a day or something, well, not a lot, but regularly. But anyway, in the train, I was smoking and just...
And he didn't smoke at all?
No, not at all. And he suffered all that, and I said no word because I just couldn't drag myself from what I was thinking. I remember what I was thinking, and I was just proving with Theorem, and No way. I still feel very bad about that, but I just couldn't change it. Of course, he didn't say anything, but definitely was very offended by that. Yeah, it was really very offensive on my part, but I just couldn't. I mean, just,
what were you thinking about?
This theorem I proved about bound and Bechtel numbers of manifold positive curvature.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And I was crystallizing.
Bound on Bechtel numbers?
Yeah. All manifold of non-negative sector curvature have universal bound and Bechtel numbers.
I see.
And the moment it was crystallizing in my head, and just absolutely, I couldn't. And it was much stronger. You know, there was this point. It felt very bad all the time, but I just couldn't change. So, yeah, but that's, I think, is a typical to all of us. Yeah, when you are getting obsessed, you just cannot do anything. But on the other hand, when you go out, you may display a different level of responsibility for the outside world. And you take it from somewhere, yeah, it's a limited amount of mental, emotional energy you have.
So that's what you think he meant, Feynman? That kind of responsibility?
No, I don't know what he meant. This is hard to say, yeah. And actually, he was not that responsible. He was, in a way, quite responsible. He was kind of pretending kind of being responsible somehow. He has definitely some quite reasonable principles. Sometimes he was behaving rather obnoxiously, as written in his book, if you remember, yeah, he was.
Uh-huh.
But this irresponsible is just, of course. When people emphasize that, that doesn't mean, you know, if they truly irresponsible, people don't need to say that, yeah? And they actually believe themselves being very responsible. You know, that, yeah. He was kind of trying to curtail his responsibilities because exactly he felt responsible.
Are you responsible?
Well, reasonably, yeah, of course. I mean, we all just with age become responsible.
With age?
Yeah, but when you're young, you don't really depend. Nobody depends on you, and you may be responsible. When there are people around you which you're related to, you automatically become more responsible.
Uh-huh. You had a dog once, right?
Yes.
And that was a huge responsibility.
Yeah, dogs, of course, yeah. Dogs are a huge responsibility, exactly.
How did you find your dog?
It was accidental, which is before we were leaving the country. And I found it on the street. And the dog was hit by a car. And with my friend, we brought it to the doctor, and the doctor said, okay, the dog will recover, and we couldn't find the owner. And so I had to take it with me. And it was sticky because you had to have some paper to come to this country. And you need about 40 days quarantine, how is it in English?
Mm-hmm.
And it was no 40 days. But a friend of mine, whom I mentioned, is Adrian. He was very good at that, and he was very nice with some woman, doctor, whatever, and they wrote down this paper. Nobody ever looked at this paper. No, it was very difficult to get it. We came to America because it was written in Russian. Nobody cared, yeah. So, no, but the dog was healthy anyway at that time.
Misha didn't help you with a paper once too, right?
That was when I was getting one of my American visas, yeah. I needed some paper here in Paris, must come with this visa. So I come to this consul, they say, no, we don't renew these visas anymore. These papers anymore, we cannot give it to you. You have to go in such and such place. I go to such and such place, no, we say, you don't do it there, you have it in the next place. And then I went about five of these kind of places and came back. They say, well, we cannot do anything. Then I contacted Misha and said, okay, they can produce this paper in Washington, but just let them give a statement that they don't produce these papers anymore. So I come, no, we don't have these papers. So, and then Misha Brin, who was already American citizen, he came with me to consulate, and just all this was repeated. And then he said, you know, I'm American citizen. I stay here till you give me this paper that you cannot give this paper. Yeah, he did the paper. He just had it in a whole bunch of them at his table. Why these people do this? Just completely missed it. They already had this whole pile of these papers exactly saying that they don't do this. Yeah. And he was refusing to give it.
Yes. Oh, the one that said that they don't do this?
Yeah, exactly. The paper saying that they don't do it anymore. And then, therefore, it must be that it could be done in Washington.
Uh-huh.
And they had already a pile of them on his table, just giving exactly what the papers. And he was not giving it to me.
Uh-huh.
Because Misha said he would stay there for 24 hours. Well,
uh-huh.
Which he had the right to do. Yeah.
And Misha was your friend from Leningrad?
No. He's from Moscow.
Uh-huh.
And we met when he immigrated, and I was at Bure at the time, and he was passing through Bure, yeah.
Uh-huh.
And so then we get acquainted, and we even wrote a joint paper.
You wrote a joint paper, dynamical systems.
Dynamical system, yeah. Combining dynamical system actually with some topology. Mm-hmm. Actually, what I learned actually that it was the mathematics was similar to what I was using in my paper on Bárány conjecture, and then I realized that when I was writing this paper, I missed some references, some topology had been done by that time. And what I found also very interesting, we needed some particular technical statements in topology. And I'm looking through old textbooks, which were kind of exposing classical papers, and that was not there. Mm-hmm. And exactly what you could need kind of for application. And then eventually I looked carefully in these classical papers by Borel and Serre, and there it was, the statement. And this is exactly what we'd miss in textbooks. Yeah, now it was one of the most beautiful statements there. That's kind of, and most useful. Textbooks are not reliable, yeah.
It's hard not to organize, to write good textbooks.
Oh, yeah, it rarely happens, yeah. Well, again, the Felder probability, yeah, this one of the excellent books.
Which one?
Felder probability theory. This is kind of a basic example of a good textbook.
You've been writing, not textbooks, but at least very differently from before, the way you organize your papers in the last 10 years.
Yeah, I became a little more obsessed just to saying things clearly, yeah? Because before I wasn't doing that, yeah, compensating.
Uh-huh.
And it's very difficult.
Uh-huh.
Partly, I'm limited by language. I would say it's harder in English to express what you want. And then the most difficult, of course, to figure out what you want to say. If it's not technical statement, you don't really know what you want to say unless you write it down. And when you write it down, maybe something happens kind of nonsensical, so you have to change it. And uh-huh. This is absolutely paradoxical. It's, you don't know your own thoughts unless they're written down, if they're not mathematical or something very precise.
Uh-huh.
And then it's, of course, very difficult. You know? And I don't know if there are reasonable textbooks, reasonable books, but there are very few excellent ones.
Uh-huh.
So short books, where people write on some short introduction, some subject, sometimes very good because it's short.
Right.
But when it becomes long, you have to organize differently, and it's enormously difficult.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, my guess, any book more than 100 pages, you cannot do it well. 100 pages with the limit for a book. So it must be self-contained 100 pages, and you have to manage to do that, and otherwise it's suspicious.
What if the subject has...
So you have to isolate it and make 100 pages. Exactly, trying to connect too many things, organize them, that you just may destroy it. Because the process of organization may bring artifacts which are not in the subject, right? If but think yourself, if you cannot understand something without, of course you have to have a certain background for each of these 100 pages. But if you cannot understand it within 100 pages, so how can you understand more at a gallop, yeah? It's impossible, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And this is, I think, the way our brain works. We work in units, and then the units go to next units, and if you can make this unit poop, it's an idea of organizing and making structure, whatever, usually illusion. People do that, but it becomes, I have my own experience like that, trying to organize something and it became absurd when I do it.
Organize something.
Right. I mentioned that I was writing trying to rewrite some proofs by Nash,
mm-hmm.
And just make them conceptual, structural, organizing them, and just was absolute nonsense. It's unreadable.
Uh-huh.
Just do it wrong, you don't know. Before you finish, you don't know how it works, right?
But it's a huge amount of work.
Yeah, it's a huge amount of work, but then you write it down. First, you feel very happy, and then just a year later, I look at this, I couldn't read it. I mean.
Uh-huh.
Right? So because you introduce artifacts, nobody cares about those artifacts. You don't care about those artifacts. The idea is there, and still, there is no good exposition of that. Nobody can write this Nash-Priest function theorem to write it in good terms.
Uh-huh.
I mean, strangely, we can write formulas, or we can make some formalism as I did, but somehow the idea is extremely clear, but it's the framework for this doesn't exist. And of course, this is second theorem of Nash, also very paradoxical. And the first theorem saying that differential equations is for when you break regularity conditions, they don't tell you the same story as much as they're smooth. And another paper saying that sometimes you can inverse operators which are not invertible. So you can break all the rules, all these norms are wrong, and still you can do it by smoothing, which looks absurd. And however, he doesn't. And I remember when I read it, this for me was even more unbelievable than the first paper. you make organized computation in some way, it just comes up. And it's when you go through this carefully, you understand why it happens. But it's still kind of simple and computational. And there is no logic behind it. And many people try to rewrite it, and they are unsuccessful in my view.
Yeah. So is there something that we're missing, you think?
No, yes, it's unclear why. Well, there is no general conceptual context where it works. And I think I kind of invented this context, but the context was kind of absurd. It was not kind of mathematically, I kind of formalized it, but the language became so much heavier than the substance. Mm-hmm. And this was happening to many other people. What they do that, they incorporate the already implicitly result into the definitions, right? And so it's true by definition, so to speak, or whatever. And on the other hand, again, it's kind of a theorem, is my impression. If you use it, it means you know, something is wrong. Yeah.
What do you mean?
Yeah, I mean you don't need it anyway. And actually, it's soft. This implicit function theorem. Uh-huh. It's exactly of the same soft nature. And actually, I have several times where some people were using it. I'm saying, well, they were proving really hard theorem. I say, well, it must cancel off. It was canceling off, uh-huh. Right? It's just, you know, it's a beautiful thing, but still also kind of artifact. It's soft. I don't. It's helpful sometimes if you don't have kind of a better argument, but it's kind of hides, usually it hides, you know, in soft mathematics, it's okay. If you apply it to equation, which you can handle by classical method, but otherwise it's very suspicious, its use. Uh-huh. But still, it would be nice to understand it, but which I don't. Mm-hmm. What is the underlying kind of principle? We formulated, I kind of, I was deeply into that and understood everything in fine detail, but I couldn't articulate it. Just to say it in words. I think mathematics typically must be said in words. If you cannot say it in words, something's wrong with you, yeah, or with mathematics. And this you cannot say in words. You see? Mm-hmm. There is some very simple computational moment, and possibly there is a way of explaining it. But the category, sort of in general terms, where it happens is unknown. People say Fréchet spaces, tata-tais. It's definitely not, this was clear, but what is the right setting is unclear. Abstractly, when I wrote it, it was kind of a fixed point theorem in some kind of various particular space of auxiliary objects. But the problem was describing this object and all setting, all the definition was, well, it was absurd, yeah. And one of the point, of course, you have to generalize this probably tremendously in order to formulate it properly. It's still too special. It's probably about something else. Mm-hmm. There are this thing about smoothing, that's fine. Yeah, there are these ingredients which you can isolate and explain. But why computation fits, no, it's unclear. Mm-hmm. And it's fantastically well organized. The proof of Nash is, again, people will know the nice thing, why is it difficult to read? It's absurd, beautifully written, absolutely crystal clear, the best possible notation, yes. And everyone was complaining about the proof exactly because it was non-standard. For me, because I'm not an analyst, it was much easier to read than the all simplified versions. Uh-huh. Because objectively, it's the best, his proof. No, it's incredible paper. Yeah. Uh-huh, uh-huh. And much more kind of amazing than the first one.
You want to talk about
goal-free learning? I think it's a kind of nice concept in which I arrived kind of from thinking about the Ergosystems. And the point is, if you look at the basic patterns of human behavior, which are the most important, in a way, for us, they're not usually taken for the most important. Right? Evolutionary, if you look at like people describe evolution, what's essential for kind of survival and the emphasize, you know, strengths, you know, sexual prowess, et cetera, et cetera. However, if you look at the development, especially of human, the most important formative years are first 2 years of life. Mm-hmm. It's well-owned synaptic connection being established. Mm-hmm. And what you learn in these first 2 years is billion times more than everything else. What do you do during this period? You don't fight, you have no sex, you don't provide for your food. You play, right? The major activity of babies and animals is play. And that's major function of our kind of brain. It's play. So you have to understand that. And it has no purpose, no goal. It's just having fun, so to speak, right? And then you want to kind of try to formalize this, yeah? And so, as we know, many people who say it, extension of that art and science is continuation of this play, right? So, and the point is, what directs us in there if there is no goal? how you can move somewhere if there is no goal, right? Mm-hmm. And how you can learn something if you have no idea of learning in mind. And this is exactly how baby learns. They have no idea of learning. And if they try, if you try to push a child or animal toward learning at a certain stage, it disasters. It just stops learning. Yeah? And there were quite interesting experiments done by acquisition of languages. For one was in Nicaragua when the Sandinistas came to power, and they tried to educate mute deaf children. And they brought them to some community and tried to teach them the deaf mute language. It was disastrous, nothing happened. And then they dropped them and gone out, and children were kind of left to themselves, and they developed a language pretty fast. Exactly, because there were no teachers and there were no goals. Yeah, because it's completely different principle. When you learn something basic like language or perception of the world, when you're a child or mathematics, it's a different mechanism. And right. It's not everything you learn without a goal, but something happens without goals, and this you want to understand. Yeah, and that's what I was trying to formalize in my in this article or book, whatever it will be, on ergosystems. So what can be alternatives? And this ODA group on robotics, they have an idea of curiosity-driven driven robots. Mm-hmm. And it's very similar to what I was saying. And my point is that given flow of signals, you want to extract structure of that. Whatever it means, the structure must be interesting, intrinsically, meaning mathematically. So you have to find mathematical criteria. When you transform, you have kind of input, and you do something mathematically attractive to that. And that's more objective than anything kind of you hear in the world, at least from a mathematician point of view, right? This has intrinsic properties, and then you believe that this happens, and you want to model this kind of in eventually with computers. And this, how apparently may you should teach, well, languages definitely should be taught this way. Of course, there are many technical points, what works and what doesn't work. Say social impact for babies is non-crucial. Yeah, for example, if your babies are taught different phonemes in a foreign language, and they pick them up and pretty well up to 3 or 4 years of age, only if it's said by a person. If it's said, say, by from telescreen, it doesn't work. Yeah, and they can learn it actually up to from 7 months up to 4 years extremely well, and you can check it how they react to the phoneme, whether they learn them or not. But if they come from the sound, it doesn't work. So social factor is important. However, it's still goal-free. I mean, it's not that they have any purpose in that, yeah?
Right.
So, but you need somehow, you need some lubricants to do it, yeah? So I'm not saying it's completely abstract. And that's a point how to develop good teaching. You have to understand and accept that we don't know how it works. And there are other kind of famous experiment with Kanze, who was a bonobo chimpanzee, and his mother was taught by the psychologist to do something. And he was a baby crawling around here and whatever. His stepmother. And stepmother learned nothing. You know, he was giving encouragement and punishment, he learned nothing. And then accidentally they looked at the baby playing and left, he was doing all that. And he never paid attention to what they were saying. And that's the point. You don't pay attention. If there is a pressure, authority pressure, it's certainly destructive here. And it's different mechanism. And then we have to understand how it works in education. And this is how well education should be organized. It's not that it might be permissive. Yeah, I have to direct your students in a direction where it may be productive, but it may be productive intrinsically, not extrinsically. Of course, from some moment on, you have to learn useful things. Yeah, well, nothing you know. It's for the life is required that. Mm-hmm. But the basic learning, like languages, mathematics, maybe science, must be based on different principles.
But it's pain to learn mathematics.
Yeah, it's pain, but also it's pain like making physical exercise, but it's pleasure. I mean, exactly, you learn. You have to present it in the way you enjoy this pain. Yeah, that's the only thing. We are all mathematicians are masochistic. Yeah, you know, you suffer and suffer and suffer. You can't prove it, but on the other hand,
you love it.
Yeah, you just cannot stop. Yeah, there is an intrinsic mechanism. It switches on, and it is. Yeah, and there is something in everybody has it, of course, in their heads. There is something, and you have to find the way to approach it and just develop it if you think it's reasonable. Of course, you must be careful. Right, even if you learn it, it may be not always good for the student, even if you succeed in that. With languages, there are various theories I read. With languages, they tried, of course, much more how to learn so fast, to learn foreign language. Mm-hmm. And apparently, there are something, like under stress, for example, people apparently learn much better.
Under stress?
Under stress, yeah. The research, I think, I don't know whether it's true or not, but it was practiced to put people and just deprive them of food, and then they become really much better in learning languages, yeah. Wow. This is kind of stress. But stress may have some effects. Actually, I remember when I was emigrated from Russia and was in Vienna on my first day, yeah. And I learned German, but I was extremely bad at that. And I suddenly couldn't reconstruct or repeat any sentence in German. But then, yes, I was super excited, you know, going out, you know, like going to the moon, you know, going out of the country, then it was yes, impossible thing was happening. I was super excited. And when I was sleeping, all conversation in German, which we were during the day, just all exactly clear in my head. They were just there. So, and then
you could understand them?
No, I couldn't understand them, but they were recorded. They were recorded, absolutely. Yeah. And now they say this amygdala probably was involved, yeah. If you can make amygdala function, your perceptiveness goes extremely up, yeah. You know, the center of fear and kind of emotions. And that's uh-huh. that's kind of, actually, I envy you some people who are very much studying this very much. So but this is a dangerous thing. That's apparently how brainwashing work, yeah. And you can apparently brainwash people under stress and they start behaving in a very unexpected way, completely out of character.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it is not, of course, it's quite different. Yeah, there are many efficient ways of learning or teaching and some of them not at all desirable. But the idea that the play and goal-free learning is fundamental thing in our life and just like baby play is more important for humanity than all kind of our efforts in a way. Yeah, if not for that, we would be like apes. Yeah. At this moment, we start deviating from animal behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And that's sometimes not sufficiently emphasized. So what we value in humans, exactly what radically different from animal. But on the other hand, most things which we need for our survival is like animals. We need food, we need shelter, and this is always emphasized. That's great, but this doesn't make us human. Yeah, human, all our social interaction, all our kind of emotions, that's more or less the same as animals, slightly shifted. But this ability to play all life, yeah, and actually some animals also play all life, yeah, like, you know, dogs, yeah, or dolls also, you know,
mm-hmm.
in the wild, they still retain ability of playing, and that is a kind of our essential feature, and this must be the source, the ground for better education, probably. I mean, this is a conjecture.
How do you have any idea of how to implement this?
No, of course not. It had to be studied. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
All the things are extremely tricky. Now there is very good techniques.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, this MRI, by which you can see which centers of the brain being active for that and this activity,
mm-hmm.
which were applied recently for dyslexia,
uh-huh.
and people identified two different kind of sources of these two roots which being broken in dyslexia. When you learn to read, there are two roots in your brain which can be tracked. But we don't know what they do, of course, with MRI, but there is enough resolution to say that they're there. And they're the same for all people, for all languages.
Mm-hmm.
When you start reading, the same part of the brain being excited. And if you are dyslexic, you can see even when you're a child that this part is passive. And there are two of them. And one related to auditory system, apparently, and the second is not. And accordingly, there are two different strategies how to read the children. They need completely different programs, kind of opposite, right? And that you can see in that. And the same again in any kind of learning. Now there are MRI is one of possibilities and maybe some psychological study, but you cannot say it beforehand. But what you should be accepting, and this, by the way, observing, as some people were suggesting how to teach mathematics. Mm-hmm. Say, Paul Gorelov, in one of his last talks, gave a talk how to teach children geometry. It's completely absurd. It's exactly how he understands geometry, right? And nothing to do how the children will perceive it, yeah. That's the point. People tend to teach the way they understand. And I remember my also experiences with some friends. I was trying to explain something in my way, it looked to be beautiful, and then it was nothing. And then understood it in a different way, yeah. So, and this only can be done by rather systematic study. But
mm-hmm.
to start the study, you have to accept that we understand things very poorly, and just don't forget our preconceptions, and try to develop frame how to learn what we have to learn before doing that. But there is unquestionable evidence that learning doesn't go the way teachers believe it does, yeah? Or anybody believe that, you just don't know how it goes.
Do you know of any psychologists implementing such a program?
This was observed, you know, with animals, what I told you. It was
mm-hmm.
a great surprise with people when they observed it.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, it's certainly how underdeveloped it is. Till recently, they tried to teach apes to talk, till maybe mid-60s.
Mm-hmm.
Completely oblivious to the fact that apes don't have our kind of a mechanism. In principle, they cannot talk. period. And they're doing for 50 years. And they were scientists, and they didn't realize that. And they were, so if you look at the psychology of humans, they're probably 50 years behind this those psychologists. So how much they understand. It's extremely difficult to make to objectively study somebody else psychic. Even when it's animal, you're already being preconceived. If it's not a human, I mean, just you are. You're completely blinded by your own ego, your personality. And you have to find a way how to clean yourself of that. With animals, I mean, it worked back. First discovery in psychology, which turned psychology into science, was made by animals by Spaulding in something like 1860.
Which one? What is the discovery?
Spaulding discovered imprinting in animals.
Imprinting
in young animals, uh-huh. I think in chicken. Yeah, you know, the first moving object chicken or duckling take for their mother. Mm. And it's really remarkable thing, and it was completely unnoticed for 100 years for that reason, yeah, because it was a really great discovery, and you know, at that time, life of scientists, he was poor, was pretty bad, yeah, like Darwin, if he were rich, it was okay. If he was poor, I mean, he died poor of tuberculosis when he was 35 or something. Mm-hmm. But this was really great discovery, and then it was much popularized by Lorenz and in recent times. Because it's universal. This is exactly it. You get it. It's a very universal thing. How you learn who is your mother? The first object, period. It's very mathematical, right? It's very axiomatic. And that's how I think it works on all levels. And in animal behavior, there was a big progress. But also, if you look how people studied, they're full of kind of ideologies. Right. Some say you don't have to anthropomorphize all the others. You have to anthropomorphize all this kind of nonsense. You have to learn in a kind of open-eyed way, not being prepared by any kind of ideology. It's very difficult. I mean, when it comes to psychology, even for physics, you know, in astronomy, it took a long time to accept that we are not center of the Earth. Mm-hmm. And the same, and it's much harder in psychology. But still, there are beautiful ideas sometimes. Mm-hmm. One, I love very much this great experiment showing this, you know, the smart people there. I forgot how it's called, but some people believe they see different figures, numbers in different colors. Some say, I say 7, I see red, and 4, I see green, yeah. What? Yeah. And the red, definitely, it has some name, this property. And some people claim they have this property.
If you say...
No, if you write 4, they see it red, and if you write 7, they see it green, blue, whatever.
Okay.
Right? How to check if they're lying or not? Now, there is a great experiment checking whether they're lying or not.
I have no idea.
No, it's very, very, very smart. Very smart experiment, yeah. And it is for, you put on the blackboard these letters, and in the center there will be more 4s than 7. And the men come into the room, I see this disc here, a red disc here. And you don't see anything. And they checked and they see it, yeah. Uh-huh. Because it goes, perception of colors goes by different channel. It's somewhat faster than distinguishing a complicated shape like 4 and 7. Uh-huh, uh-huh. And so on these kind of experiment, that's real psychology, and you have to collect them, and then you can understand how your inner stuff working. And there are not so many of them, yeah, actually.
Yeah.
There are not so many, and some of them very hard to interpret. You know, these visual illusions, and they're definitely there. But the way they interpret it, I think, is just rather naive, yeah. You just try to explain it in terms which you know. Certainly it depends on something you don't know. Mm-hmm. And there is I don't want to say about something I don't know myself well. But it's sometimes it doesn't look convincing. I mean, just in a way, it just looks too childish, the explanation. There is no internal language. This is what I think Ergosystems can produce the language describing this kind of phenomena. They're hidden, usually don't notice them, yeah?
Right.
And they're all there, and you have to describe them. And some, of course, are easier, like you concentrate on the boundaries of the domain, and then you can explain very well mathematically what different, why bug in your eye do the same, why they concentrate on boundaries. Mm-hmm. Because boundary more interesting than interior.
Right.
Because it's information content. So if you're, just let me give something related to that.
Yeah.
What is freedom? This is related to this, yeah. Actually, when I started first writing, I called free learning. What is freedom, mathematically speaking? And so if you're sitting in a prison, you're not free. So imagine you put in the flat space, completely identical, you're equally not free. Because whatever you do, yeah, you have the same, right? So freedom means that you have possibility to control reaction, and reaction come to your action in sufficiently interesting structural way,
okay.
Right? And so inside of the leaf, you like on the dessert, whatever you go, you see the same. On the edge, you have now two possibilities. Either you go along the edge or go against the edge.
And you can jump.
Yeah, so you have two outcomes, and it's more interesting, mm-hmm. right? And that's, I does the same, yeah. The boundary more informative than interior. Mm-hmm. And then it happens a posteriori, of course, you automatically give you fantastic compression of information. If you want to encode domain by just dotting all points inside, only the boundary, on the boundary you have square root, yeah? And this is miracle of mathematics. The two things become the same, you see? And these miracles, they shape our thinking. There are lots of these miracles, which many of them we don't know. If not for them, I think no mathematics, it would be no mathematics and no our mentality. Anyway, so Wallace was right. It's a miracle. It's a miracle of mathematics. Mm-hmm. And mathematics, I think, is all about miracles. Anything in mathematics we are scared of, right? Talking about it is a miracle. It's not the least logical of all sciences. Right?
The least logical
of all sciences. Yeah, it's pure miracles, right? Anything you see just shouldn't be there.
Right.
Right? From another angle, it just shouldn't be true. Right. These what are theorems, yeah, is exactly the thing which shouldn't be true, but still true. Uh-huh. Right.
Hard to keep, to not get an ideology, right? When you're surrounded by miracles.
Of course, ideology is always there, but if you're aware of that, you can make correction. Of course, that's the whole point, yeah? If you want to see things clearly, you have to know you don't see them clearly. And just to guess what errors are, all this aberration, any experiment in physics works, right? You know all these errors and you have to subtract them. This is difficult to any physical experiment. If you start doing this naively, you see God knows what, because you don't know what to subtract, all these artifacts, and you have to subtract them. And that's one of the points. So you have to know your biases, and you're full of biases, of course. Yeah. It's right. Very hard to admit them, of course. Yeah. But you see them on the other guy, yeah, that's, you know, if you're two, it's much better.
When you talk about this subject, or biology.
Yeah.
These are the new topics. So there's the usual danger that this knowledge might be used to make weapons, blah, 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 whatever. But this is not so interesting because this is not new. But here there's something quite new, which is your scientific results might modify quite dramatically how people think about themselves and how lawmakers make laws and this kind of stuff. So that sort of morally freezes a little bit, but one has to shake it.
Yeah, no, this is just, this discussion was in this country for a long time, how much this people are responsible for their action and what the hell it means, being responsible, not being responsible. Mm-hmm. And it's a very tricky way. You don't, you cannot scientifically answer that, yeah? And but on the other hand, there are ethical principles. You want minimally kind of punish people, but you want, on the other hand, you want to protect society from questionable characters, and you don't go into these details. Yeah, you put this borderline, and that's it. And you cannot go into fine detail who is responsible, who is not responsible. If something horrible happens, boop, these people must go out of circulation. And responsibility is a second issue. But the major issue, however, which is much heavier on that, the decision must be right. If there are errors, I think in the 90% cases it's the error of police, of judges, of whoever, which makes evaluate situation incorrectly. And the point is not just changing these ethical principles, but to raise up the quality of the study and to decide what actually happened and what scientific evidence for this or for that. And the ethical principles, I don't think they're that crucial. No? If there are mistakes, they're not because of that, but just because the forensic science is still very underdeveloped. Mm-hmm. And the quality, and this is definitely true, that at least till recently what I read, most people working in forensic scientists with police, with judges, with those who couldn't find the job otherwise. They were the lowest kind of see people mm-hmm. at best, yeah. And that's difficult to change. It's not so, it's so interesting job for a scientist, yeah? On the other hand, it requires scientific thinking to properly evaluate, say, evidence.
Forensic,
yeah. It is non-trivial.
Like pathologists?
Well like pathologists, you know, that's expert on fires and expert on, for example, the type of bullets going there, the type of wounds, and et cetera, et cetera. And there are some very nice ideas sometimes come from science, by the way, which works pretty well, but many, I think, still are very old-fashioned
and then there are absurd tendencies which come and some come, some disappear. There was a book by somebody about statistics for judges, yeah, and it was complete nonsense. On the basis of that, they were arresting people, you know, there is the spontaneous death of babies, which happens rather rarely. And so computation was, so it happens twice in the family, this was a murder. And so some 100 people were put in the prison because chance 1 to 10 million or something.
Oh, wow.
Right, and these people are sitting in prison because the judges, in general, the whole profession, were accepting this person who wrote this book, who was incompetent either in biology, in medicine, or in statistics,
mm-hmm.
but was writing in a nice style, which is acceptable. I think some of them now went, were liberated. When mm-hmm. there was big kind of motion, especially by biologists, saying, well, there are genetic factors, there are these factors, who knows what. It's absurd, yeah, to multiply, let's multiply. Think if probability, multiply them. That's the point, yeah? You always multiply. A plus B equals C, period. And it's not like that. Which, by the way, probability is a very tricky subject, yeah, to explain what probability is. And
mm.
I spoke to some statisticians, which are very kind of good professionals. They don't understand what probability is. They have very kind of naive ideas
mm-hmm.
what probability is, which starts kind of pushing them further. Yeah. What is normal law? Why is normal law? What means it? When you can make model by normal one, what happens when you change parameters? They know many rules, and in practical terms, maybe reasonable sometimes, but they don't care
understand.
For that. They don't care for that. Yeah, it's not in their culture.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly, it even more applies to people which are from mathematics. This kind of knowledge. Must be there. In this book, Bapowers, this is another good example, by the way, that there was some crime being committed and there was a man being described by certain parameters, A, B, C. And then they found such a man and he was brought to justice. It was Los Angeles because chance it was accidental, 1 million to 1. And the judge was smart enough to say that in Los Angeles there I saw 8 million people. So there were 8 like that. So it means nothing, right? If you bring this parameter, you always find some, yeah?
Right.
And this is, he was a smart judge, yeah?
But
otherwise he could go to prison, right? And this happens very often, say, understanding what is probability and what the chances are.
Mm-hmm.
And we must admit, we don't understand it, yeah? It's not kind of, people are stupid. It's very tricky subject,
probability.
Yeah. And in mathematics, I was saying very many times that it has not been revised for about 70 years.
Probability
theory, right, because at that time, you know, there was Fisher and Kolmogorov came with formalism and Fisher and they were discussing Bayesian approach, sequential approach, this, and then stopped. And people got tired of that and they accepted sort of the formalism problem and then it was moving. But I think the discussion should go on, yeah. Right? There is no unique answer. One, I think, mistaken principle, there is unique answer. There is no unique answer. In each moment you have to think, but you have to understand there's various possibilities and every time you have to make a decision and there is no easy decision.
Mm-hmm.
Which kind of scheme, which kind of approach give you a right perspective? In practical terms, yeah, it is crucial. It's not something just forever given to you. And it's not just, just a rule, multiply A and B. And it's not so easy. And I think in forensic there are other cases when misuse of probability and people go to prison.
Mm-hmm.
In another famous case about a woman, I think it was in Denmark, who was attending kind of very sick people. And then during her stay, several of them died. And they say, well, probability of this so low, people, and she was put to prison. And there was a whole statistical, I think, Society of Denmark, and there was some movement just to show it's absurd, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Because these people were just, she was prepared, she was always really very kind, woman, and she was taking somebody else's turn with most difficult cases.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, these people were dying more often, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then she went to prison. And I think she was actually freed, yeah. But I'm certain there are many other cases.
Like
yeah, and this is where education is crucial.
Yeah,
it might be just kind of formalized, and there must be some principles. It might be written once and forever, and so. You don't allow deviant and stupid kind of opinion going around, but in many cases, yes, yeah, because any time there is established opinion of is a danger, you canonize it, and then it may happen to be wrong.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, when there is canonized opinion, immediately there are deviants who just produce all these crazy ideas, which are maybe the critical aspect of them may be okay, but what they suggest may be just even worse. So it's, you know, to balance things are
quite hard.
Yeah, it's very hard. Yeah. If you have some statement, say, even very vague in biology, mm-hmm. but still you have millions of experiments, and even each of them happens only what you predict only 6 times out of 5, if you put it to the power of a million, probability it was accidental is just eventually zero. Mm-hmm. In mathematics, if you take a good theorem, maybe only 100 brains went through that. In each of them, there are all these neurons could misfire. And therefore, probability it's right is zero. However, it's right. So it's a miracle also on that basis, right? And this is least convincing and least logical, because you cannot objectively verify non-trivial mathematical statements. It's only because there are some brains which accept them. And that's and it's miraculous it happens to be true. It just we don't understand. There is no reason. Of course, it can be eventually explained, but we don't understand why, right? And that in that way it's miraculous. And another point, if you take, just I was making some example, like with this Lagrange theorem, that if you take numbers mod p, they make a field, yeah? Mm-hmm. And if you just try to abstractly see what it means, I'm sorry, this set and the two operations, they have such and such properties, ta-ta-ta, and you see probability of this n goes to zero super exponentially. However, it happened for prime numbers. Uh-huh. And it's a miracle. And just you take any good, if you take like Fermat grade theorem, it's not a miracle. It's absurd, would be otherwise. If there were solutions somewhere far away, that would be a miracle. But of course, statistically, you don't expect them. Right? For that reason, it's not so exciting. On the other hand, if you take something like what actually proven, this Teniamoway conjecture, it tells you there's certain absolutely kind of random sequence of numbers, this solution mod P properly organized, give you function extendable to the whole plane with functional equation. Oh, that's a miracle. Right, and that's what makes mathematics. It's incredible statements. Yeah, you take something from a side, it's just that shouldn't happen. It happens super exceptionally and still happens. And then, in a way, it's true about many things in life, but you kind of used to this miracle. We see them every moment and they can be verified. Right, like any physical law is a kind of a miracle, the things always have come the same. Yeah, you make experiment and the same constant just come the same. It's a miracle, but this you can verify independently. Anybody can verify it. And mathematical statements, nobody can verify except for mathematicians, except for trivial ones, which are just numerical. Uh-huh. And there's no way to objectively you have to believe an expert. You know, 20 experts believe in this proof. Whilst that's proof, it's 20, yeah, and it's huge things. And there's no question there are a lot of minor errors in the proof, I mean, uh-huh. right? Like in any long proof, there are lots of minor errors. But still, it's true. You know, it's true. You're convinced it's true. Right. It is much less convincing than any fact of physics. And this contrary to perception, we believe mathematics is so kind of it's convincing, and we believe it because we have this feeling that we understand it. But again, as a mathematician, you know, sometimes you completely convince something is correct. You write it down, sheer nonsense. I mean, so this belief is very shaky.
So the idea of mathematics being eternal, you find that...
No, I mean, it is apparently true, but we don't understand why. For reasons so far miraculous, because we don't know the reason for that. How it happens that you think about, your two different brains think about something, come to the same conclusion. And then what happens in your brain has nothing to do with logic, of course. It's not logic or something else, because these things exist in a certain way, and they can crystallize in your brain by some mechanism, and this mechanism probably similar, maybe they're dissimilar, and how it happens. What means mathematics outside of you, I don't understand. This we cannot point this to talk. But if you speak about what actually the processes in your brain produce, because you already have a mathematical model and you have a circular argument, so you use mathematics to understand mathematics, and therefore there is a chance, yeah. Only circular arguments have some power, despite what people say against them. And they like mathematical logic, it's certainly circular. You try to then mathematics, but there is some quasi-convergence in the loop. Of course, there is no convergence. And this way it's miraculous. All great mathematical theorem are not supposed to be accepted, like physics. Also, I think one point of education, you teach people like the law of Newton, and only the most stupid people accept them. If you're a student and you say, given the law of Newton, you say, yeah, it means you're a complete idiot, you understand nothing, right? You're not supposed to understand it. Everything counterintuitive, you have to remake your brain to accept them, right? It's not just fact you learn. You have to readjust your mentality to accept them. And this one of the, I think, faults of teaching mathematics or physics. If you're given like Pythagorean theorem, it's a miracle. It's true, right? You have to explain it's a miracle, and students should be really excited it's a miracle, and then they only can learn it. And they're not supposed to believe into this, right?
And that's, I think, what is about mathematics. Inside of mathematics, we become so used to this miracle, we accept them. But from outside, the only way it can be perceived as miracles, if you kind of, something you don't, you're not supposed to believe, right?
Yeah.
And I think it's quite remarkable. This one of the way I think maybe will make learning is more exciting, yeah?
So how do you think that people conjecture the Pythagorean theorem?
Oh, well, it's hard to say. There were examples, there were particular numbers. This was written in textbooks.
Uh-huh.
But the way you see it, of course, the usual history is not important. It's what miracles. You take this stick, you know, and project it on three walls. And here, three shadows, you measure them. No matter how you turn it, the sum of squares doesn't change. It's a miracle. And it's a miracle there is an orthogonal group. And why orthogonal group? It's a huge non-commutative entity, extremely unbearable. To write, actually, in matrices, even rotation is very painful, right?
Yeah.
You need complex numbers. You cannot write a matrix for rotation easily,
mm-hmm.
or in three space. And here it's non-commutative, so it's all, and you know this group determines lots of things in this world. You know, in quantum mechanically, the symmetry, the spectrum of the Schrödinger operator, all them shows all come by Pythagorean theorem. It is a miracle that such a thing, orthogonal group, exists, and that we can perceive it. And it's unclear, actually, if you perceive the group or something else, yeah, because it's a huge transcendental object. It has no rational approximation, yeah?
Mm.
On the other hand, and this is probably true, what we do see, again, I'm sorry, this is so technical, it is the dual space of the group, the core algebra of representation, which is discrete object, an arithmetical object.
Uh-huh.
And that's what enters the physics, yeah? And actually, now there's these quantum groups, whatever, they emphasize these points. Think about this. You cannot describe orthogonal group without introducing something like continuum. Like circle, you still can approximate by polygons. You can't approximate sphere by something symmetric.
Uh-huh.
Right? And probably it's kind of, from physical point of view, it's artifact. But representation of it is kind of in the composition of the tensor product into the reducible one, that probably physical reality. And mathematically, if you think about the kind of conceptually, that may be quite reasonable. Because you don't introduce this very strange thing as continuum. You don't need continuum for that. It's just about integers, right? And continuum is just a strange thing which is, helps you to understand it, but kind of illusion of your of set theory. And I think in mathematics, lots of such things, we don't quite understand their origin. But the orthogonal group in Pythagorean theorem is, you can't believe such thing possible, like SO2, SU2. I mean, if you just describe these properties, and you know, when you construct Lie groups, it's a fantastic identity, some cancellation happens in the set presentation, just incredible cancellation happens, and the group arises. It's a miracle they exist, and we just accept them. And mm-hmm. of course, many of this orthogonal group built into in our bodies, what I was mentioning, you know, rotation in your joints, rotation in the other lecture in your eye, we kind of have already some intrinsic knowledge of that, because in the physiologically. And it's probably crucial for functioning of your visual system or motor symmetry system of your body. This non-commutative group inside of your kind of brain already, given it not neurologically but physically, physiologically.
You recently met David Lynch.
Yes.
And how did you like?
No, he's a great man. Yeah, obvious. Yeah, he's. As I was mentioning before, he's full of gifts. He's super artistic and musical, and he's very kind of emotionally perceive everything, including mathematics, which he certainly doesn't understand, but he has a feeling for our kind of excitement. Yeah, he is very resonate. Yeah, to mathematicians, and it was a tremendous pleasure to interact with him. And he was showing me in some old lithography in Paris, and he was so excited about all that. And I also was excited. We share this excitement because interesting things, and beautiful, and all things. Yeah. So you easily can go along with him. Yeah. I think mm-hmm. in general, artists and mathematicians we are very much in the same way because we like logical things. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So what did you do with him?
There was this exhibition made by this Cartier Foundation.
Mm-hmm.
It's called in English "Beautiful Elsewhere." Just translation from French, some sentence by Grothendieck.
Mm-hmm.
It's some exhibition dedicated to mathematics,
mm-hmm.
made by artists, so artistic perception of mathematics.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And much of this design was done by David Lynch and by some other people. There were some, I don't remember all names of all designers, but they are beautiful, your beautiful designs. And then we also had some collection of sentences from science, from various people.
Like quotes?
Like quotes, yeah, from different sources. And altogether, you see, I think, it has reasonable interest by people in Paris.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I thought you first may expect only mathematicians would like it. What I like, the very end, this model of the robots who uh-huh. interact with the audience, yeah, interactive.
And that model of the robots had David Lynch's designs, right?
David Lynch's designs. They have externally, yeah, they made by David Lynch. Internally, of course, they by this group of ODM.
Uh-huh.
And
sort of implementing this idea.
Pardon was just making this movies of some mathematicians. He's extremely. He made another very, very remarkable movie, by the way, about processing in court.
About?
In court, what happens in court? Some minor misdemeanors, uh-huh. and some judge talks about them. And uh-huh. I think it's extremely kind of well made. And what the way it is, there are various people, you know, somebody was stealing something, and somebody was selling narcotics, and somebody was doing that. And this woman is very, the judge is very intelligent, very kind, very nice to everybody, and just trying to do the best. And then there is a guy from CNRS.
From?
CNRS, a scientist. Uh-huh. And he was accused of carrying a knife he's not supposed to carry. And he says, I look at the law, such knife, the folding knife. And how incensed she was. How can it? I know better. She completely lost anything. He lost all kind of patience.
She did.
She did. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Because he was. He know what he was saying. He did, you know, was not defenseless. She was complaining why he was arrested, uh-huh. etc. Yeah. And that's everybody. We all like that. Yeah. When some mathematician even come and touches your domain, you become very kind of easily negative.
Offended.
Not offended, but become negative. And just actually, this was a story with Eliashberg. He had an idea, and very right idea, to prove some theorem.
Yeah.
And he came to me, who was supposed to know better, and I said, no, it cannot work, and convince him it cannot work. And then a year later, it was done by Thurston, actually.
Ooh.
Yeah. Exactly this.
Did he came back?
Yeah, because I made a mistake. I thought it cannot work, but something I misunderstood at some point, and that's it. And this happens, and it happened also to me on the other side. Yeah, I will come to somebody who's expert some idea, say, oh, it's nonsense, and then somebody else in 5 years does it. And it happens, yes. We all react this way. So, but there it has shown very picturesquely. Yeah, and the Pardon is extremely good.
Uh-huh.
And he's very chic himself. He's also an artist. Yeah, he's excited about what he does. You know, just all the time he thinks in terms of how things will be perceived by a camera.
Uh-huh.
And so it was also very, very pleasant to interact with him. And he tries to be kind of look conservative. Yeah. He kind of pretend to be kind of bourgeois and conservative, but you know, then it shows up immediately. He's not at all all burning, yeah, inside. And that's what makes it pleasant, yeah.
Is that like the general thing you enjoy about people?
There is a fire in you, yeah, and when there is fire in people, yeah, it's pleasant to see when somebody's burning rather than just, and we all, I think, if a given condition can burn, but unfortunately there is too much water around, yeah, you're drowned. My things, yeah. Actually, this already is in Goethe. Actually, I don't remember citation in German or in English, but Goethe more or less expresses this idea
uh-huh.
that we cannot burn because we're lost in the little things,
uh-huh.
in the sand of mundane. But this, of course, is exciting about people, yeah. Artists, of course, scientists, we all like that. Yeah. And this, of course, develops. This, not that you are born with this, by the way. I'm pretty certain. Because I was observing some how it happened to my colleagues and to young people and how they develop, and it's very often it's just condition of life, how they will be turned, and if they go this or that direction, this kind of internal intensity develops slowly. You mm-hmm. know, when you people young, more or less all have potential, but then it disappears, and sometimes you people don't have this. But very often, because they make wrong choices, or life pushes in the wrong direction, so potentially there is much more. I think people who could live in this very active, internally active way, and it just doesn't happen by accidentally.
Mm-hmm.
And these usually most productive people in society, so scientists, artists or scientists, they do new things and move society in a certain direction. And this is very hard to promote educationally, because, you know, there is a joke that reasonable people adjust to this to the world, and unreasonable people adjust the world to themselves, and therefore the world moves where they push, but reasonable people. We cannot have too many unreasonable people in the world, yet, otherwise we just go going on random.
Right.
But we need a definite percentage of them. Mm-hmm. And these are very hard to sustain, because education has two opposite purposes. One, to produce unreasonable people, and the other hand, to produce reasonable people. Right? They're both crucial to society. How to do it in the same class? I mean, it's very unclear. And the opposite, right? You need completely, absolutely opposite way of teaching, right? And that's one of the problems for education.
And also for choosing who.
No, choosing is just, it's another matter. Yes, how to educate people, because you need simultaneously to teach two opposite things. Be like everybody else, not be like everybody else, right? So how you can teach that?
How was in Russia, this search for individuality.
It was dominated by politics. And so that on the top there was this politics, but nobody, of course, neither in the teachers nor students believed into that. So it was always the double talk. And it was, in a way, even fun. Yeah, there was always a double talk. All the other thing was tangential to this, I would say. And perpendicular, there was everything like anywhere else, but then there was this layer, unconscious often, of this double talk, double thinking. Well, of course, it was not so rigid, not so cruel when I was already being educated, because it was after the death of Stalin, and so you were not risking being kind of killed if you say something wrong, but you may have trouble, put it this way. But it was not that deadly.
You never got into trouble?
No, I never got into trouble, no. But you really have to do something, definite action. Just if you just say something, it's not. On the other hand, my friend, now my friend Gorban, when he was 16 or 17, it was the time of the invasion of Czechoslovakia, and they wrote some, on the walls they were writing kind of protests. And they were arrested, and he spent about a year in the psychiatric clinic, and he was treated by this, God knows what. He barely survived, And it was disgusting because these doctors perfectly understood the situation, and nobody checked them what they were giving to him. They could give him, injection of sugar, glucose, and they still treated him this way. And you cannot respect these professions. I mean, it's very, very, very unpleasant situation. They were doing that, and they were not forced. And this was actually typical of many things under Soviet regime in my time. People were behaving in some way, not because they were actually anybody checked them, but they were self-checking themselves, right? Mm-hmm. And actually, I remember the particular story, and I think it was about the next Congress, which was taking place, I've forgotten where it was, I think it was in Canada. And you have to nominate speakers. Mm-hmm. And so myself and somebody else, I'm originally were in this panel for nomination, And he was asking whom to nominate, and he said what he wanted to nominate, this or that or whatever. And I said, I already nominated. But he said, this, for example, I was afraid to do because such and such authority would be unhappy. And I asked, well, how they will know whom to nominate? Okay, I have to tell him. No, you would ask him to tell this, right? Nobody would ever ask me what you do in this kind of correspondence. But some people believe that they should follow these rules, but nobody, the top guys had no idea who goes, who's a good guy in the mathematical community and who's politically bad. It only was known to this close-up. And this close-up, some of them I don't want to name, they were great mathematicians, and they were going reporting to the party staff what they were doing and checking with them if they were doing it right. Of course, they said no, but for the psychiatric institution, it was systematic, and the doctors were doing that for no reason. It just they were believing this was required of them, and nobody was checking them. Mm-hmm. And nobody could check it. And that was extremely very painful. And I know personally this way very well, Gorban. He was kind of a genius, and this would kind of destroy his life. Of course, he's still a fantastic, gifted man, but that destroyed his youth. Then he couldn't get, of course, education. He was kicked out of Moscow, and had a very complicated life. Mm. But he was a very strong person, so he's still a very successful scientist. But this was happening on a systematic ground. But then you had to do something, like that. right? You really show protest, but if you're just telling jokes, it was my time, it was less innocuous. But in time of Stalin, of course, well, you just go to prison, right? Immediately. Mm-hmm. Even if you don't tell a joke, but somebody said, you were telling the jokes. Yeah.
My question was more in the lines of, at least American television showed the USSR like everybody was the same. This was a cliche. You know what I mean? Everybody was uniform, the same on TV, like naive TV.
If you look at any country which is sufficiently different, for example, the style people dress, they all look the same, yeah? Because we only distinguish details and the things we know well, right?
Right.
Of course, it is like look at any other show from outside, it will give you the same impression.
Uh-huh.
Right, and then of course what they were showing the same pictures all the time because they have very few probably shots.
Right.
Having two shots and always showing them on all occasions.
Right.
Which actually I observed, I realized that during the first Iraq war.
Uh-huh.
And they were giving reportage every time, showing the same video all the time.
Right.
And just giving different stories about it.
Uh-huh.
Right. So, and then of course also in Russia they were very limited what they could shoot, and so they were showing the same. And for that reason it looks the same, yeah?
Yeah, but do you think that you and your friends were more looking for individuality and this?
No, I don't think we thought in these terms, yeah. It was just there. You don't think about your individuality. I mean, if you start thinking individuality, that is a stupid thing to spend your time thinking of, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
You think about things which are outside, right? Not about you. Of course, you think about yourself, but not kind of this idea of individuality. It looks to me rather silly.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just we all have it, but it's not, you don't spend time thinking about it, or concentrating on that. Right? You can develop your individuality, you concentrate on development, not on individuality, right? Right? You're concerned about your body, you don't think about your body, you do something with your body, that's the point,
right.
Etc. So you don't think in those terms.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it was, it's cliche also, I think, in America very much to think of my individuality and just this formula. But this formula just means nothing, it's just cliché used by media and then picked up. People still, of course, don't think in those terms. In Russia, there was not a cliché. Very many things you think just because there is an expression, ready up an expression, and they fit into your language, and you believe you have something about them, but they're just linguistic cliché.
For example?
Like individuality.
Mm.
Emphasizing individuality versus something else. It's just a cliché. It shows very little meaning. In Russia, what do you think? It was some collective thinking, it was individuality, but of the people in power. It was just this gang of people who took the power, and they were just pursuing their individual interest, period. And it had nothing, and then there was some kind of propaganda of certain kind, not. And everywhere locally it was happening the same way. It was always pecking order, individuality, the usual structure. Physiology was somewhat different. But the basic human nature was the same.
Your generation is very different from the one before.
Well, because the generation of my parents went through the war. And it mm-hmm. was absolutely, of course, experience which shaped human mentality. And then the other generation who went through this period of Stalin terror, which also, it's something. In this respect, of course, we are different because we were not under this pressure, neither the war nor terror. And then we had to properly understand people who went through this experience. It's very mm-hmm. different. Well, you're going to survive if you don't change, don't adapt to that.
Mm-hmm.
Because you see, it's commonly people were saying, just many under terror, and also the same saying would be in Germany under Hitler, we didn't know about that. If they didn't know, they wouldn't survive, right? They behave in a way shown they knew that, right? Just any relaxed behavior, you disappear. And so well, they knew it, but they knew it indeed in a way subconsciously, kind of. Right, this double thing apparently not so difficult to develop,
mm-hmm.
and they refused to think about that. But they knew what to do, and this is applicable to this generation. Well, during the war, it's another story, but it's certainly another kind of pressure. Like when say Rokhlin, who went through this war and then through the camp and then through another camp, you cannot imagine what happens inside of you when it happens. You're really different here. They are completely different parts of your personality being activated, and then they become frozen again. And you have many potential, I'm pretty certain that when you're being born, you can really become very different person depending on conditions. You have already these stereotypes ready, waiting, and one of them take over. And, well, whichever takes over. Mm-hmm. Say, the war is a very good test, yeah, how people change during the war. We have, you know, many stories about that.
Yeah, quite dramatic.
Actually, now we've seen this in Iraq, these horrible stories about these camps, yeah, and this again stereotype behavior.
What?
When they were torturing people in Iraq camps, yeah. This is stereotype behavior. It's absurd that it was not was taken care of beforehand. Mm-hmm. You know, there are lots of tests before that that we easily can slip into it. Nobody immune, yeah. Mm-hmm. We get into a position of power, and then something really you never suspected, how horrible things were inside, and this just shows up. And you must be in control, you have to know that. Yes, to know it may happen, and just you're responsible, it wouldn't happen. And it's, if not, if especially if you are young, yes, we are not completely control what we do. We only control if you know that we should control it. If it's a new thing, yeah, you never met some inside of you, something happens you never met before. You don't know what's right and what's wrong. Yeah?
Right.
It's just, words is not useful.
Mm-hmm.
So, and psychology, yeah, very, very important science, and but it's kind of, even that what is understood is not certainly common knowledge, yeah. And then there is, of course, the adult discrepancy in psychology.
Extreme.
Yeah, because it doesn't have a good kind of foundation like usual medical science.
Mm-hmm.
Medical science, now there is a huge science, it may be a question, but still science. In psychology, there is no such basis, abstract kind of science.
Let's talk a little about literature a little bit.
Yeah. Well, I can't say much about literature.
Well, you can tell me which writers you like.
Yeah, basically, if I like something, it's poetry. More than, I don't like, essentially, well, I like, you know, adventures, you know, from science fiction. Pratchett, I think, was my last love, yeah. Pratchett is a great man.
Uh-huh.
But it's not really what's called literature.
I call it literature.
Yeah. Well, serious people, you know, in my surrounding, you know, all this, very cultivated people, they wouldn't consider this literature, but I think he's great, yeah.
Uh-huh. You told me a quote the other day from him. Your life, no.
Yeah, no, but everything, his books, especially the first in his series of this Discworld, are full of fantastic quotes. And one of them, just before he dies, just all life runs before your eyes. And this is called life. Yeah,
right.
No, but he's full of these quotes. He's just a completely genius. Yeah, you're catching, you know, you always say this sentence. People in your life before you die, but they don't realize, yeah, how paradoxical it is. Yeah, and he full of that. Yeah, he sees how absurd many things we do,
uh-huh.
And he makes great fun of this. And he's a fantastically imaginative person and very good person. Is that?
And before that, who was your?
Yeah, well, I don't know. Yes, you know, yes. The last one I read him, everything else looks to me kind of so much below.
I see.
Yeah, he's much superior to anything else.
Unlike your own mathematics.
Well, I don't know. I can't compare it to the mathematics, but it's really.
No, I mean, but the mathematics you remember the most are.
No, no. Of course, I remember what I read. I mean, but I'm saying that it's kind of shadowed. Yes, everything I read before looks to me so naive after him. Yeah, he looks to me so much clearer, so much cleverer.
Uh-huh.
That all these writers I read before, they look to me like babies. Yeah, compared
uh-huh.
to him. I mean, yes, I still can enjoy reading him, but I just. And also, I found his language, well, my English, very limited. But I felt some consolation when you take something from him. Most native speakers also don't understand the words. If I look in the
uh-huh.
dictionary, they have to look in the dictionary. Yeah?
Uh-huh.
And actually, I learned quite a few. So when you read it, you have to look in the dictionary quite a bit. Yeah,
uh-huh.
He has this fantastic kind of, and for me, it's an extremely nice choice of words and very, very, very vocabulary, the construction of sentences. Yes, first it was difficult to read, in fact, even there. But I am very skeptical, kind of, from this ergo point of view of the classical writing, because they're all exactly on this kind of animal side of our existence. It's fun, but how much you can take it all about this?
What do you mean?
Just any classical literature, it's kind of about mundane life. It's just exactly not, yeah, pressure is exactly about your imagination, things which don't exist, it's just a fantastic play. And then authors are damn serious, yeah. Serious meaning about what happens to you, how you eat, how you have sex, how you fight, whatever. It's all what animals do. And I would prefer to read about animals. I found more interesting all this about animals, because about people it was said again and again and again and again, again. It is boring. And you cannot say anything new, really. It's overemphasizing this part of life. Yeah, it's not, I mean, it's there, and you cannot neglect it, you cannot reject it, but how much you can say. It was said already, you know, by Gomer beautifully, and just why to repeat it again and again. In a way, nothing new has been said, but like prejudice, you really new things. You really find new aspects, way to look at life, which nobody else has seen, yeah? And I read classical various kind of literature, you can enjoy reading it, but in my view, it's much more primitive. Yeah, it's just kind of completely.
Serious?
It's kind of, people like Tolstoy, they're kind of a genius, but the genius of mundane, yeah? He's just genius how it show trivial things. He's fantastic in doing that, but these are trivial things, yeah? Uh-huh. They never, exactly what happens, like perfect photography, they don't have imaginative.
Shakespeare?
Shakespeare is somewhat better in this respect. Yeah, he's poetry. Yeah, poetry is another story.
Well, the theater is narrative, though.
Yeah, but still, it has some kind of, it's play. You see, it's not quite serious. Yeah, it's removed from reality.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I'm very kind of this kind of realistic kind of, or surrealistic, but it's around realistic, and that's reality. It's our reality, and it's much more interesting to describe it as we describe behavior of ants. If you can do that, this will be fun. Describe human in a scientific way, and this will be really interesting. Yeah, you can make an example, whatever.
Uh-huh.
Or you make plays, like in theater. And it's exactly the emphasis that there is this play. And this, you're in a different mood, yeah, we perceive it, like Shakespeare, because you play. You're not serious. But with this kind of so-called serious literature, I think, I like it, you read it, but I find it, especially after reading Pratchett, this I think how it should be.
Uh-huh.
In this way, you can go much further than he done, but that is a direction which you find you really excessive, at least as a mathematician maybe.
Is there a movie that you find in that?
No, movies you cannot do that well, because movies don't provoke your imagination.
Some do.
I like some movies, but it's not the same level there, in my view. You cannot make a movie with pressure.
You cannot?
No, absolutely not. Because you see very much inside, it's implicit, and many things you never notice, and there are lots of references to other things, yeah. Some I know, some I don't know, right? And very, for example, he beautifully explained the principle of solipsism, you know that?
No.
He proves solipsism is right, and he said, I may be misquoting, horses are reluctant to step backward. What they don't see doesn't exist. Horses don't like walking backward, because what they didn't see doesn't exist. Right? This is exactly kind of solipsism. And horses are perfect solipsists, yeah, in this point of view. Right? And this is certainly much better than all this, you know. And that's, and he touches many other philosophical questions brilliantly, yes, showing exactly their meaning and in this very funny way.
Uh-huh.
Like solipsism, it's just idiocy. I mean, just all this discussion, not right or wrong, but just idiocy. Like when we speak about, and he just showed this in one sentence. And this was about a dog, about a horse who was making this remark, because the horse which was there, the horse was usually carrying the death, could walk backward. It was Dickie or something, I forgot the name. This horse was able to walk backward.
Uh-huh.
I forgot what the name of the horse which was belonged to death. You remember? You read it? There was a real horse which the death was riding. On
death,
one of the characters of the one of the main characters actually there, and there was I have forgotten the name of this horse, and this horse was able to walk backward.
I see.
Unlike other horses, believe she or she was, I think he believed in what was she couldn't see or couldn't he couldn't see.
Uh-huh.
Right. So this about literature, but of course maybe some much greater literature. I may be missing a lot, yeah, because I discovered Pratchett maybe 3 or 4 years ago and was very excited about that, yeah, because I didn't know about him before.
You were telling me that painting excites you less than pictures of animals.
No, I think good photos, photographs, I find more exciting than the great paintings. Yeah. Uh-huh. I can appreciate and distinguish in a way, well, up to some level, the quality of paintings, but the patterns you find in nature, I find more exciting.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, they caught by great photographers. Yeah, they maybe more, I find them more exciting. But that's, well, my limitation. I don't know my limitation. What is that property? I'm not making point of this. That is a fact of life. I can't enjoy painting as people do. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And apparently, I'm just missing. I'm pretty certain by looking how other people getting excited, I'm missing something. But what can you do? Right.
Right.
You have limitations.
Right. I give you two papers.
Yes.
One is in statistical mechanics.
Yes.
And the other one is in the Lang lens program.
Right.
And then I introduce you to two mathematicians.
Yes.
And you have to tell by their behavior which one wrote.
Behavior meaning doing what?
They're going to be in a room. You're going to know.
They're doing nothing, sitting in the room.
No, okay, let's say.
I can't talk to them or?
No, you cannot talk to them. They're in a party next door.
Only observing them.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, well, I think, well, you know, that's exactly about this joke about mathematicians being introvert and extrovert.
Okay.
And Lang lens, of course, will be introvert and another extrovert. And you know the difference between mathematician who is being introvert and extrovert. And when you speak to introvert mathematician, when he talks to you, he looks at his shoes. Uh-huh. And extrovert looks at your shoes. So that will be the difference, right?
I see. What can we do to improve the collaboration between different fields and between mathematics and sciences?
On any such question, when you ask what to do when you have this basic problem, there is only one answer. You have first to design a way to study the problem. You know, not just to study it because you don't know it, but start to designing how to approach the study. After this, first you design how to make the study, then you organize the study, then maybe you know the answer. This you're giving. Saying this or that is just silly, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
But the part of the design, of course, must be a design of the education. It's just scientific education and positioning people in the situation where they can interact. And, well, there are many parameters, but you don't know how they work. And with mathematicians, you know, it doesn't work well if you try to push them doing something they don't like. Yeah, they just don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
And often turns out counterproductive.
But you liked what Tadai was doing, right? Which is not quite what I'm saying.
Yeah, François Tadai, he is a biologist who promotes education of all kinds, in particular education of molecular biology to scientists, to physicists, to the students in École Normale. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And he has a particular kind of institution, even when he invites people from different countries and different professions, and they talk and interact.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the more you have of things like that, the better. It will be, yeah. So you have to have some positive moves. The basic idea, you have to make positive, not negative moves. You have to create some structures that attract people to the structures,
mm-hmm.
not just to limit their behavior. Like immediately people become resistant, but that's certainly there is no simple solution. But of course, the more we interact, and the richer will be our intellectual life, and the potential outcome will be more interesting.
Mm-hmm. Right. He was really impressed with you because you won the Abel Prize, and then you asked him that you wanted to talk to young students, 18-year-olds or something, and you went there and just spent time talking to each of them.
I would enjoy even more interacting with 2-year-olds. Yeah, you know, the younger the people, the more pleasant interacting. I wouldn't say 2 weeks. Yeah, it's not so interesting. But from 1 year on, yeah, or from 2, the people become less and less interesting, yeah?
Uh-huh.
Right? Because you have more individuality exactly at the peak of your kind of intellectual kind of start developing at about 2 years old.
Uh-huh.
And then you become more and more the same, yeah? Anyway, if it's not true, babies also, everybody's the same.
Uh-huh.
But they're so different from us, yeah? And so you can learn, you see different aspects. Of course, we are programmed also to like children, the young people. So it's no rational explanation. Of course, talking to young people is more fun than to old people, yeah?
Uh-huh.
With very few exceptions, right?
But some exceptions.
Yeah, there are exceptions. People who can remain kind of infantile till the end of their life, yeah. Actually, I had a friend of mine who died recently, who was a painter. He was one of 50 survivors in one concentration camp. He was a Polish Jew, and he was a painter, and he survived, kind of miraculously, accidentally, he survived. And he was this kind of guy, he was kind of infantile, he died, he was about age 7, he was very sick most of his life, he was very, very sick. Yes, and he was like a baby in a way, yeah? He was very poor, and nobody was liking his painting because horrible thing, a surrealistic thing about concentration camp. And he was certainly was, psychology was shaped by that. And this horror was always him. On the other hand, he was like a child, yeah? He was a reaction, like actually a capricious child, I would say, yeah? Extremely enjoyable person, I loved him a lot, yeah? He was spending a lot, much time in the hospitals. And so some people are like that, yeah, and just they always reacting and kind of impulsively and unexpectedly.
Right.
And children, of course, are very good at that, yeah. And 18 years, those people better than 20 years, and 28 better than 38, and just you go with age, you don't become better, yeah. And when you see young people, you can imagine you're also young. That's another factor. Yeah. You forget, because we all know whatever age you think we are young, yeah. Of course, when you see all the people around you, start doubting, but if everybody young, you can, well, if there's no mirror around, it's pretty good, yeah.
How do you manage to have all this energy? Do you have theories about it?
No.
You do realize that you have more energy than the average.
Well, I have energy.
To say the least.
Partly it's not that I have more energy. It's a certain style of behavior, yeah, right? I'm kind of, like that. But it doesn't mean, in fact, maybe that I'm...
No, but you can be thinking for a very long time, very intensely, yeah. And you don't get tired. Most people get tired.
I almost get tired. When I think about mathematics, I'm getting tired. If I know, when I'm talking like that, I'm not getting tired.
Yeah.
But if I was spending, like, usually my day thinking about something and now I'm stuck with, after that, after 5 hours, yeah, I'm like that, I'm still continuing, but I feel, mathematics is the most tiring thing, yeah, in the world. I'm actually tired most of doing mathematics. Nothing tires more than doing mathematics. And physically, if you live physically exhausted, yeah, when you do mathematics. When you really concentrate, especially when it doesn't work, yeah. Yeah, and no other kind of course, physically I have limitation what I can do, but still I feel much better when I do comparable physical effort compared to mathematics.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, mathematics is, I know if you have the same feeling.
Yeah.
Mathematics
is
horrible. In a lecture, you listen to some difficult lecture. And sometimes, on the other hand, I remember you listen to a subject you don't know, history, linguistics. You come out of there fresh, yeah?
Yeah.
You don't remember much, of course, but you're fresh, even if you concentrate. And in mathematics, I wonder if it can be recorded, say, by like some MRI, that indeed you consume a lot of, I think you consume indeed a lot of energy. You have a lot of flow in your brain or something. I think it's physiological, it's not just mental.
Yeah.
And this is kind of part of your training as a mathematician. You learn to make this effort, right? And at the beginning, it's nice. When you start doing this, you enjoy it. But then, of course, you're tired, you don't like it, but you cannot stop anyway, right? Usually, how
it works. It's too late.
Yeah. You're getting sucked in.
Yeah.
And
I've noticed that you eat very cautiously.
No, I eat everything. I just don't like junk food. Mm. Everything which I can perceive as reasonable, I eat everything. But just anything, any normal cooking, I don't like much like meat, but there's tremendous variety of vegetable, corn, whatever. I love everything, yeah.
Uh-huh. In your talk at the Perelman conference in Paris 2 years ago, you made two pretty funny jokes about chimps, I think.
Yeah.
So actually, the quote was, are there orangutans among topologists?
Oh, no, the contrary. Are there topologists among orangutans?
Sorry, yeah.
Yeah. And they show some ability to unknot complicated knots.
Uh-huh.
And it's not a joke, this is what I read in some book about orangutans.
Yes.
That people put, boats in the river and they make very complicated knots because they know orangutan may tie and untie them. So still they come and tie them and take rides on the river on the boats. They love it, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. And secondly, there was some particular youngster, orangutan, who was making, given a piece of a tube of a horse, he would make a ring and just pushing his body through this, yeah. Uh-huh. Obviously enjoying that. This topological thing is really exciting. Yeah, I go around, he has this non-trivial one cycle, and he goes about this one-dimensional homology. Uh-huh. And orangutan is appreciating this, yeah. It's really exciting when you perceive there is a cycle around the cycle, yeah. And he was loving the idea going through this cycle. And this very much topological perception, right?
Right, absolutely.
And I think we share that, yeah? It's some abstraction of our spatial perception. Mm-hmm. And apparently they have it in some degree. And not all of them, again, I guess it was exceptional. This character was rather exceptional.
Right.
But potentially, of course, others have, and here just shown up. So there is in their brain also, there is this abstract machinery, topological, I don't know what, which sometimes demonstrates itself.
And this was a good way to measure how far topology reached, right?
No, well, then I was saying that we separate from orangutans about by 30 million years.
Right.
It's because we branched, yeah, we're about 15 million years ago, or 20 million years ago, 12 million years ago. So we're rather far from them. But uh-huh. Still we share. And then actually we're still not quite clear why orangutans are so smart. Because on one hand, of course, they have a very complicated problem with their foods. They have found very many different foods at different periods of time, but still they're unproportionately smart. Uh-huh. And then it's unclear why. Not to speak about people, why we are kind of have intelligence. There is no reason for that. Yeah, it's extremely kind of heavy burden. Yeah, uh-huh. We would be much better off without it as a species. Obviously, well, it's no nobody understand, of course, where it came from, why.
We would be better off without it.
Oh sure, yeah.
No, come on.
Of course,
we not, rule.
No, this absurd idea. We rule. Well, forgetting just today, right?
Yeah.
Because this rule probably, with high probability, will end with disaster, right? Everybody
right.
expects that, and it's unclear if we'll find a way out of this disaster. Mm-hmm. But forget about that, Ted. Look when we actually were formed, and this was about, you know, say, 500,000 years ago. Mm-hmm. What was the point of having this extra intelligence? Granted, you have to pay for that, right? For any feature, you have to pay, and the price is enormous, and the price is difficult childbirth. And so, because, you know, you have a big head and you just cannot go and women die and children die, what's the point? What's the point of having the big head? I mean, just, it cannot outweigh, apparently, this disadvantage. And it's not impossible, it was not for any kind of selective reason. But once, you know, some genome switch there, you just keep going, yeah, for some which we don't quite understand, yeah. So we don't, I don't think you can explain it in simple words, like anything when people try to explain selection papaya is bullshit, yeah. There might be mechanism which is hidden and which is not understood. There are some indicators, of course, what could have been a factor. Of course, the role of language, uh-huh. is social structuring and how it works, which we don't know, but we can imagine some very strong positive feedback loops involved. But still, it's if you compare pro and contra, so far what we know, contra is against it. Uh-huh. Right, because I think the death of child, you know, is tremendous, yeah, much higher than any other animal. And that's a major factor. So the productive coefficient was going down with the growing head, you see. So it was quite likely to be an anti-selective factor. But there was something else. It could have been another parameter, mm-hmm. which was not that obvious, which we don't know, and which was not present anymore. It was there, it's not anymore. And with orangutan, this problem, they didn't, and also this posture, having this posture is also extremely disadvantageous, mm-hmm. creates lots of problems. And they were going along, and it's not clear what the mechanism running it. Of course, there was selective pressure, but it's not obvious pressure. It was something we don't know what. It was this, almost for sure, it was a positive feedback loop, but we don't know what are other kind of part of this loop. We can only make conjectures, and they may be very naive and may be wrong. Mm-hmm. And then maybe our nature could have been erased, yeah. Could have been some infection, you know, some viral infection, some part of the environment which is not present anymore, which was driving it, right? And just all naive explanation are just words. They may be even right, but they just, you never know whether they're right or wrong, unless you make some, genetically maybe you can make some discovery and analyze comparing genome, ours and apes, to see what was happening. Mm-hmm. Because we know there were quite a few particular gene doubled specifically for us, not for apes, you know, this chimpanzee whom we are closest. And maybe you can understand what these genes were doing. And this was accident, they just doubled, period. and they were fixed accidentally, and then bloop, there is no way back. Right? It maybe could have been like that, yeah, not for any rational reason. This apparently is how people perceive now many steps in evolution. It's a big accidental thing happens, and then boom, there you are. You have to survive in these new conditions. Completely counterproductive in a way. It would be much better off without it, a priori. But in the long run, we mean ruling. We mean rule. We are not rule. The world was and will ever be ruled, hopefully, by bacteria. Okay. They rule us, and they rule the world, and their majority, and they survive probably long thereafter. We'll be gone, yeah. Right.
This is true.
Right, so.
But we made
the whole idea of ruling, I think, is an absurd idea. Ruling,
it's kind of stupid, but the world looks very different.
Oh, yes, it looks very different. It certainly has a big effect, but that means it's I think we're better off. I'm not saying bigger. Right? Mm-hmm. If you assume bigger is better, I mean, better off having much longer potential kind of evolutionary lifespan. And certainly being developed so fast, we curtailed it. As a human, we cannot survive as long as we would survive as apes. Apes, you know, the species may exist without change like cockroaches for 200 million years. And we don't have a chance to survive 200 million years. I mean, no way, right? 100 years will be not so bad already.
So. You mentioned a possible relation between thumb spaces and a certain article of to biology.
Well, it was not quite serious, but there is a pattern of seeing manifolds in Tom and in this paper by Ache, not as a surface in a space, but a set of normal directions. You have the normal sticking going around, and this is exactly how cells are made, and they're made of this lipid material, which is going around, and this fantastic kind of organization, and its physics effect behind it, not only, but also combined with biology, because it's lipid also, and also proteins. And mathematically, nobody studied them as a mathematician. Physicists, of course, tried everything and they studied them as physicists, but mathematicians never studied this. They never looked at them. And mm-hmm. they're mathematically fantastic, forgetting proteins as pure, this bilipid layer, and how it being taking the shape and solving different differential equations and how it kind of statistically behaves. When you change temperature, that's fantastic. Potentially, maybe fantastic mathematics behind it. And even simple question you ask, you can really formulate as mathematical equations, there is no proof. Yeah. I tried to prove one thing, why erythrocyte has a circular symmetry. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't prove it, it's difficult. Mm-hmm. Now, once you know circular symmetry, you can shape, let's say, why it's biconcave. Yeah, that's, I think, probably easy to compute.
Once you assume the symmetry, compute the shape.
Because some differential equation, uh-huh. and the differential equation you can analyze. It's ODE. But when it's two-dimensional, it's PDE, and why it has a symmetry, it is quite difficult. You know, there is a very similar equation in geometry. And geometry is very much, especially back in Russia, they love this question. And it is that if you take, among all surfaces, with given intrinsic diameter, the maximal area achieved by doubly covered disk. So the general, we take all convex surfaces with a given intrinsic diameter. Mm-hmm. And then area become the largest per given diameter when it's just two disks glued over the circle. And again, the central point, it has circular symmetry. Once you know circular symmetry, it's trivial to prove. Uh-huh. But I think erythrocyte is a more exciting example. Uh-huh. It also has the circular symmetry. And it's typical when you make, when you have a really kind of very kind of nice functional, then you have full symmetry. And when you say that they're slightly less elegant, they have still partial symmetry. And I don't think there is a mathematical theory for that. And you can imagine really grand theory in starting from that. That's instance of a suggestion coming from biology, from mathematics. Of course, the full theory will be completely useless. Yeah, who cares? It's a symmetric period. You don't have to prove it, right? You know it's symmetric.
Right.
So what interesting actually happens to this erythrocyte, if you slightly perturb the conditions, you choose some acidity or whatever, they immediately change their form, become erratic. Uh-huh. They become highly kind of, I've forgotten it has some name, this distortion of erythrocytes if you put them in the wrong conditions.
But they are able to go and come back?
I don't know. because it never happens, fortunately, in life. Uh-huh. But it only happens in artificial conditions. And this was kind of people who were excited and studied that. If they come back or not, I don't remember. I once attended a lecture on the subject. Uh-huh. And it's rather esoteric, but very interesting subject. They're not that stable. Uh-huh. The stability is only in particular fluid and a particular acidity, ionic concentration, whatever. So that's also interesting. You vary parameters and solution become completely erratic. Right.
That's cool.
Yeah, it's cool. No, this is a fantastic thing. Mathematics there may be incredibly interesting, but you have to do it. Yeah, it's not, you cannot do it like that. Yeah, you have to work on this.
Think
and just study first what is known. It may be very suggestive already. There may be some numerical data, there may be experiment, and they may give you ideas also about your mathematics. Mm-hmm. Just how to formulate the problem. Of course, the most difficult to formulate the problem, what is the formalism, how to express it.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know about physics, yeah, how physically well you can describe this. I spoke to some physicists who were not excited about that, for some reason, statistical mechanics, well, because they think about in general, but they were very theoretical, statistical mechanics.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you know, there is temperature, you have phase transition, so you have that kind of, in principle, you kind of know what happens. But to go next level, it's you see, because it's not true that under any kind of condition you would have that.
Right.
But on the other hand, what is true that still it's rather common. So you may have only five parameters, but even there is a point when this remarkable, this definite region when this happens. This was specific of biology, right? You have multi-parameter system, and this behave in an incredible way only in a particular region of parameters, right? And so what mathematically can prove this? It's very hard to prove such thing exists when it exists. So I have to first to prove something very general, why this happens. That things are chaotic except for some region, and the region exists. And this we know also life exists only because of physical parameters in a certain range, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's looking incredible, but still from point of view general, it's just few parameters, you know, 10, 100 peanuts compared to the trillions of cells you have and molecules in you. So it's not that many. On one hand, it's highly improbable. On the other hand, well, you know, just a few parameters.
Mm-hmm.
You can adjust them by having sufficient number of universes, yeah?
So how do you like the Kleiner's proof of your theorem?
In principle, I'm against this kind of questions, yeah?
Yeah.
Because it's kind of a matter of my liking, disliking, and opinion. Who cares?
Okay.
Right? So you can divide humanity in two groups. Who likes, who dislikes.
Uh-huh.
So it was a binary distribution, so what's so interesting about individuals? Distribution may be of interest, right? But not what the individual think about that. Therefore, I'm reluctant to answer such question about my opinion about anything.
Out of the problems around this theorem, groups of polynomial growth, problems and related results, which one do you find exciting?
No, but the question, the main problem still unsolved. The most exciting development was discovered by Grigorchuk of group of intermediate growths. And this shifted the problem from polynomial to this x plus the square root of n. And here, this conjecture by Grigorchuk, and this very remarkable conjecture to show that this is a borderline between polynomial and non-polynomial growths. Before it was exponential, but you know it's not exponential. It may be, I'm not certain they can come close to square root, but it's very plausible conjecture.
Mm-hmm.
And this, for me, is a central topics. First, there are these groups of Grigorchuk, and this fantastic kind of rich and developing interesting field. And then conjecture, if there is something in between or not.
Mm-hmm.
If there is something in between, it will be even more exciting. But kind of pessimistic conjecture, that's the borderline. But then you have to solve it. And for me, this is a kind of, in this aspect, the central problem now.
Right.
And it was changed, yes, after the discovery by Grigorchuk of the self-similar groups and they know this. Very cool. And they kind of double. These kind of tree structure, they double in this by square root. And this Kleiner proof is, of course, much better than the original proof. Yeah, it certainly takes more, it's more straightforward. But on the other hand, it's unclear if you can adjust it to cases where the original doesn't work.
Uh-huh.
Because the patterns, the kind of the underlying properties are either the same. Then you use different mathematics, but kind of this elementary stuff which you need about groups of polynomial growth, you use the same property. Mm-hmm. And the one which you cannot use in many cases, in other cases. No, there are many potential. There are two directions. One is intermediate growth, and the second is hyperbolic systems, when you expect something of the kind. In none of them you have the basic, this is a doubling property, yeah, what you don't have is doubling property. Once you don't have doubling property, you cannot do anything with either method. And this is most elementary, yes, it kind of takes two lines to prove for groups, but if you don't have it, you cannot go anywhere. And that's, on the other hand, I would be curious to understand exactly the interaction between this proof and the Montgomery-Zipin theory, because I never studied in detail their proof. And you kind of understand essentially the meaning. Now, there was some kind of development of people in mathematical logic of this Montgomery-Zipin theorem. People close to Khrushchevsky, even Khrushchevsky himself wrote some papers about that. But there was some younger man. I remember, I have to read again his paper I received half a year ago. They found model theoretic approach to this Montgomery-Zipin theory.
Oh, well.
And put it into quite amusing perspective. But of course, it will not help you with this intermediate growth. You need, I think, radically new idea.
Mm-hmm.
And or maybe there are examples. But that's really this gap, and it's extremely kind of intimidating, you know. Yes, you have these groups which nobody expects, of course, the Grigorychian groups. And they're kind of rather simple, the whole world of the groups, and whether there is something else of this kind.
Mm-hmm.
And that's I think, this, from group theory point of view, this is a major challenge. And from dynamical point of view, this understanding these hyperbolic systems, abstract kind of hyperbolic system, which again, like group, the combinatorial object defined almost like group by generators and relations. But this basic symmetry, this doubling property, it's unknown if it's satisfied or not. It may be satisfied always, and then would imply not exactly this kind of result, but pretty good. You can apply eyes of the method to understand them.
Mm-hmm.
But that's unknown. This stable and unstable foliation, if they have doubling property.
Mm-hmm.
That's unknown. And there is no counter example in sight, and there are very similar questions in different planes of this hyperbolicity. It has a very simple interpretation. You have kind of a cell, the organism is divided all the time, yeah? A cell divides always by the same rule. That's kind of the very, very naive question. And the only thing, the rule for division is the cell divides only depending on what are his neighbors, its neighbors. And the fact is that after division, the new cell organism, all cells will have the same patterns of attachment they had before. There were finitely many of them, and they keep in this class, which is non-trivial condition. And then you start growing, and then you normalize the unit shape. If the shape kind of stabilizes in the limit, or it kind of pulsates all the time. And if it stabilizes, and kind of essentially means doubling property, and you can go to the limit. If not, I mean, it's even more interesting. So it means that this fine combinatorial development, purely combinatorial, you have combinatorial data, create this complicated asymptotic patterns, uncontrolled pattern.